two out of three series, is moving on to the Women's College World Series. You take a look at our bracket, winner of the series. We'll move on to Oklahoma City and get the winner of the Texas-Oklahoma State Series. That'll be their first game in OKC. So excited to actually be here on site, Courtney Lyle, alongside three-time All-American and national champion Kayla Breaux. And let's start with this Florida team. They're the four seed in the tournament, getting to host. They've been impressive in all areas, but I loved their defense last week.
It's been really incredible. You add their pitch.
Florida team, they are the seeded team. They looked pretty impressive last weekend, won in a lot of different ways, but I loved their defense.
Their defense is so solid, and they have the ability to make so many quality routine plays to support their pitching staff, but they also have the ability to make big time plays like this. Hannah Adams at second base is one of the best fielders in the entire country. She showed it off in regionals last weekend. And you were talking about their pitching staff. They are so consistent. They're led by Elizabeth Hightower. We're going to see Natalie Lugo today in the circle. But their ability to pound the corners is so strong. And then, talk about clutch hitting. The Gators have been nothing but clutch this season. 8 walk-off wins on the year.
Yeah, 4 of those walk-offs in the month of May. They are top 10 in the nation in ERA and fielding percentage. They have outscored opponents in this tournament 19-0. So Georgia has a task in front of them. But the good news is the Bulldogs can certainly swing the bat.
They are a young, gritty, and gutsy team. And they're not going to let any deficit get to them because of this, because of their ability to hit the long ball. They are so aggressive at the plate. 78 home runs on the season. And 1-9, they can get the job done at the plate.
Yeah, their bats have kept them in so many games. Remember, they had to win their regional final 10-9 to advance, but they did it. 78 home runs on the season. Watch out for those Georgia bats. First pitch of game one of this super regional, just moments away. Game one winners have advanced 81% of the time. Fans are ready to go for game one of this super regional here in Gainesville, Georgia, Florida. Pretty fun matchup. And we will have Natalie Lugo getting the start for Florida in the circle.
Yeah, going with Natalie Lugo, and I think it's her ability to throw some different stuff, some off-speed pitches. She's got a beautiful changeup that she can throw in any count. Besides that, she'll throw in the mid-60s, and she's got a rise ball and curve ball. But the setup pitch is absolutely the change, and she's going to play that rise and curve off of her primary pitch, which is the changeup today.
Yeah, so she will be facing this Georgia Bulldogs starting lineup. It's presented by Capital One. Sydney Chambly had a really nice regional for her. 4-10, a couple of home runs, and of course 6 RBI. Her defensive plays were great too.
Oh, she played a phenomenal left field. But for me, the biggest key was in the Duke game, game 3, to advance to the Super Regionals. She gets on base 4 times and scores each of those times in the 10-9 win.
So Savannah Sykes, the third baseman, will lead things off for Georgia. Remember, these two teams faced off in the regular season. Florida won the series 2-1, but Georgia won game one of that series.
Yeah, it was Mary Wilson Avant that we're going to see in the circle today that led the way. Did a really nice job against the Gators, but Georgia's going to have to score a lot of runs in this ballgame to keep up.
And remember, Florida has not given up a run in this tournament. First pitch inside to Savannah Sykes. You know, Sykes, one of the older players for Georgia. She's a junior, but this is a young Bulldog lineup. We talked to associate head coach Tony Baldwin. Loved the mentality of this group last week, though.
Obviously, the good thing about this Georgia team is, yes, they're a little bit inexperienced, but they don't let that get to them. They don't let deficits get to them. They make sure they're ready to go. They control their energy levels really well. And that's something that they've had to figure out as the season's gone on. And they keep getting better and better at that as they progress through.
3 balls sent in to Savannah Sykes. And that will be a strike. I think it went off of her bat.
Yeah, Lou Harris-Chamber's going to try and argue this one a little bit, because on first look, you're not sure if it hit the Evo Shield on her front left arm. You're not sure if it hit the bat first.
Did she lean in?
Correct, yeah. Is she over the box?
I think she pulls away, though.
That's interesting. I'm not sure if it made contact. It might clip the very, very, very end of that front shield on her left arm. But they're going to keep her in the box.
Yeah, so it's three balls and a strike to Savannah Sykes. And now the count runs full. Easy play to right field for Bailey Goddard. And there's one away. Well, Florida was certainly impressive. They're coming off a regional final that saw Elizabeth Hightower throw a no-hitter against USF. That is a fantastic softball team. Georgina Corrick was great in the circle, but Florida was just better.
Yeah, you have to give so much credit to this Florida pitching staff and what they were able to do last weekend. USF's a tough team. They're a team that's familiar with Florida as well. They play each other many times over the course of the season and throughout the years. And so the fact that they were able to go and shut them out twice and give up no hits, if you're Elizabeth Hightower, is very impressive.
Yeah, I was kind of surprised to not see Elizabeth Hightower in the circle today.
You know, I'm right there with you, and the only thing that resonates with me a little bit is Georgia hit Hightower pretty well, not great, but got to her a little bit in the regular season. And then I go back to Georgia's strengths is the home run ball, and how you can handle that if you're a pitcher is to throw that changeup very often. And Natalie Lugo has one of the best changeups in the SEC, maybe in the country.
Sydney Kuma at the plate, 1-1 count. Swing for strike two. Yeah, when we talked to Tony Baldwin, the associate head coach for Georgia, he said when they faced Hightower the first time, her changeup was not being thrown for a strike, so they could just lay off of it. It wasn't effective, but you're going to see an effective one from Lugo. And there's no doubt we're going to see Hightower at some point.
Oh, absolutely. And again, this is a play, too, because I guarantee you Georgia prepped more for Hightower than they did Lugo.
Kuma swings it over to Hannah Adams at second. Two outs. And as good as Elizabeth Hightower was, this defense behind her, I mean, Hannah Adams, I've watched that play that she made to keep the no-hitter going, at least 10 times.
Just so smooth, and they're so controlled. This is the identity of a Florida Gator team, is they just take care of business defensively. They're calm, they do it fundamentally correctly, but they also have the ability to make the big time plays because they push that at practice. You know, Coach Tim Walton likes to have them play web gems at practice and go out. And, you know, after talking with them about Hannah Adams specifically, there was the play that she did this weekend that she made look routine, but that's because one day he asked her, hey, do you think you could throw like this? Do you think you can make this play and do it? She's like, I don't know, I'll try.
Yeah.
She goes out there and does it.
Yeah, she's one of the main reasons that Florida has, you saw, that sixth fielding percentage in the nation. 0-2 count coming to Lacey Fincher.
And you can see right there, that's where Lugo is going to be effective. 0-2 count. She's got the changeup in her back pocket. She throws it low and out of the zone, but still, that's a hard one to lay off of. And she's going to keep continuing to throw that as the game goes on.
2-2. Good save by Julia Cottrell to leap up and grab that one behind the plate. Fincher looking to be the first Bulldog to reach today. Won't happen. Natalie Lugo and the Florida defense taking care. 1-2-3.
Lugo getting the start for the Gators. Starting off this super regional, going 1-2-3 with the big K at the end.
She's been steady all season for Georgia and will get the start in game one of this Super Regional. It's Mary Wilson Avan.
It's the senior coming in. She feels most confident in her stuff right now. She throws in the mid to high 60s, and she's able to sprinkle a lot of different pitches all over the zone, can really locate on all quadrants, but she's got a really great off speed. And Mary Wilson Avant, her movement is just so stellar. She has the ability to spin it up and place it perfectly. You can see right here a little curveball that paints the outside corner, induces the swing and miss. And then she'll be able to mix up speeds as well, just really getting some good quality swings and misses for the Georgia Bulldogs.
Remember, she has seen this Florida lineup a couple of times already this season in the regular season, but Charlotte Echols has been playing some of the best softball, and she is dangerous at the plate.
She's so dangerous, and it's because of her ability just to not slump. She only has 3 strikeouts in the entire season, just so consistent at the plate with her swing and her mentality.
Those were the starting lineups presented by Capital One for Florida. Hannah Adams leading off. She was the hero in their first game of the regionals. Well, multiple times, probably last weekend, but did have the walk-off RBI double against USF in their first meeting last Friday. That one will bounce foul. Adams, a first-team All-SEC selection. Of course, All-SEC defensive team, too. How could you not put her on there? And what a difference. She has just flipped a switch as her Florida career has gone on to get so aggressive out there in the field.
You know, she was very consistent when she first came onto campus. She only had one error at second base her entire no errors her entire freshman season. And then she blossomed from that consistent player to being able to make big time plays, to stretch her range, to stretch her ability to try things that are a little bit outside of the box, a little bit outside of your comfort zone. And it's created a really well-rounded, consistent, but flashy second baseman.
Rolled it to Lacey Fincher, one away. You know, if you're Georgia, you feel good because you've got Mary Wilson Avant in the circle. There have been times, though, that the defense behind her has struggled a little bit. We've seen some great plays, too. It's just been inconsistent.
It's really been the routine plays that have hurt them this season. And they're a young team. Talk about a true freshman, Ellie Armistead at shortstop, Cindy Kuma only has the experience from last season at second base. So they're a little bit more raw. You have Lacey Fincher over at first, who's really the veteran in the infield. But Mary Wilson Avant is really the leader of this defense. She leads from the circle. She leads her pitching staff. And she's made all the difference in Georgia's success this year, coming back for that fifth year.
Emily Wilkie at the plate right now, behind to Avant, 0-2. We welcome you to Gainesville for a little rivalry battle. Georgia versus Florida, game one of this Super Regional. Courtney Lyle alongside 3-time All-American Caleb Rowe. These two teams, of course, met in the regular season. Georgia took the opening game, but then Florida took the series. We are expecting a battle this weekend.
Oh, without a doubt, it's going to be a great series. Except there's that hint of that rivalry. These teams know each other so well. We're going to see some really good performances in the circle. And you can't help but mention for Florida how clutch they've been late in games, and on the other side, how explosive Georgia is as an offense with their home run ability.
Yeah, Lou Harris Champer's squad had to win their regional final 10-9. It was a shootout in Athens, but they were able to take down Duke, who was the seeded team, and advance. Georgia unseeded, while Florida is the number 4 seed in this tournament. Mary Wilson Avant in the circle for Georgia. No surprise, she is their ace, their leader. Facing Emily Wilkie, and that's the first strikeout for her.
This is a big time pitch from Avant. She's able to go with the rise ball outside of the zone, moving up and in on the hands of Wilkie. And that's where Mary Wilson Avant's strength is. She has the ability to throw so many different pitches. She can throw a curve, a screw, a rise. She's got a drop. She's got that great off-speed ball. And that's what makes it tough for these opposing hitters, is where do I zone in on? What quadrant do I look for? What pitch do I sit on? She just has so many options that it's tough for these hitters to make decisions.
Now with Charlotte Echols at the plate, she has given a first pitch strike to every batter today. That one goes right back at Avant. Ellie Armistead there to scoop it and make the toss to a diving Fencher. Three up, three down for Florida, scoreless here in Gainesville. Presented by Capital One. Man, it's already been an exciting Super Regional so far. We're not even 24 hours in. Florida State was able to take down LSU, who's the better seed. They win that one 1-0 thanks to Sydney Sherrill's bat. And then how about Virginia Tech? Keely Richard looks so good. UCLA had five errors in this game, and the number two seed goes down 7-2. Alabama, Caleb Rose, Crimson Tide. A clutch pitching performance from Montana Fouts. It got scary there at the end.
It did. Game down to bases loaded, full count. And she strikes out the final batter of the game to get out of that one. But, you know, if I'm watching this tournament and I haven't played yet, and I'm one of the teams that's still around, man, you got to be on upset alert. You got to be ready to go. We've seen two upsets, FSU over LSU and obviously Virginia Tech over UCLA so far.
And we do want to let you know, too, Oklahoma won their first game just moments ago against Washington 4-2. So not the 24-7 slugfest that we saw in the regional final, but Oklahoma still getting the win. This will be Sarah Mosley leading off for Georgia. Natalie Lugo and her defense took care of Georgia 1-2-3, ending with a strikeout. Lugo getting the start over Elizabeth Hightower, who had a no-hitter in their regional final against USF on Sunday. Florida's pitching and defense have been so solid, but you've got to know in the back of their mind they're thinking about every single one of these Georgia hitters, especially Sarah Mosley. She might be the definition of clutch.
Oh, without a doubt. She's had some incredibly big hits this season. Whether it's a home run or a single, whatever it may be, you just feel like when she's playing some of the toughest competition, she elevates her game. And her teammates recognize that. We got to talk to some of these Georgia players and ask about Sarah Mosley, and they're like, oh man, we know she's gonna get it done. And even when she's on deck, she'll be like, hey, don't worry, I got you. I got this, yeah. I'm gonna get it.
Oh, she'll have to wait though. That's back-to-back strikeouts for Natalie Lugo.
Not only is it back-to-back strikeouts, but this is her second strikeout in a row looking, and gets them a little curveball in the outside corner. Beautiful location, just freezes up Sarah Mosley on that one. Off to a really great start.
Jada Kearney, the center fielder, steps in now. What makes Lugo a better matchup for Georgia?
Yeah, I think it's her ability to really mix speeds. And we talk about Hightower mixes speeds too, but Lugo's got that changeup that is so nasty that drops a ton in velocity. And that sometimes is the equalizer between a home run hitting team, is having the ability to go with that pitch that's going to buckle up the knees, that you can throw for a strike, that when they're down in the count, they're going to have to hit that pitch or try and foul that pitch off.
The last time we saw Lugo was against South Alabama last weekend, had 11 strikeouts, only gave up two hits. travels all the way down to first, and Kendall Lindemann.
That was a really nice pitch sequence there by Lugo to be able to hit the corner for a strike looking and then work it out a couple more inches so you induce an easy ground ball for your defense. And that's something else that we talked to this pitching staff about, is they don't have to go out and strike everybody out. They trust their defense.
Sydney Chambly takes the first pitch. It's in foul territory, and it'll be scooped up by Sarah Langley. That was a quick inning for Georgia. Lugo rocking.
Ripped in the air to center field, back at the wall.
Walk-off style against Texas A&M. It just feels like they have their number.
High drive, deep left.
A two-run walk-off shot.
Florida will be the one seed in the SEC tournament.
Adams, the walk-off RBI double. Eighth walk-off for the Gators this year.
And four of those walk-offs have been in the month of May. This Florida team has been clutch. They've got their walk-off walk down pat. They are dangerous all the way through the seventh.
You know, and I look at that, and the reason for their ability to hit those walk-offs is because they don't panic. They know who they are. They take care of business early in the game. They trust their pitching staff. They trust their defense. And they know if there's outs left on the board, they've got a shot. And that belief has created that huge string of walk-offs, this huge string of comeback wins this season.
Kendall Lindemann will lead off this inning for Florida. It was a 1-2-3 inning in the first. Lindemann coming in on a six-game hit streak. She has reached base last 11 games. Stays fair.
Yeah, man.
And Savannah Sykes makes the play. Well, the Women's College World Series returns to Oklahoma City. The action begins Thursday, June 3rd at noon Eastern, live on ESPN. For more information on the 2021 Women's College World Series, go to NCAA.com, the official online home for all 90 NCAA championships. Both of these programs have been to OKC before. For Georgia, the last time was 2018. For Florida, the last time, of course, 2019. They have been there the last three Women's College World Series. You know, you mentioned walk-offs. Julia Cottrell had a big one against Texas A&M.
And she's such an important factor for this team, because so often throughout this season, we've heard so much about Kendall Lindemann, Charlotte Eccles, Hannah Adams, and who else in the lineup would have the ability to step up? Well, Cottrell, especially during the middle of the season in SEC play, was really the one that stepped up, and that's the reason that she's hitting behind Kendall Lindemann in the lineup. And they missed her for the SEC tournament. She wasn't able to travel with them, and having her back is a huge deal. Coach Walton said he felt the difference. He felt her absence. And she plays such a key role in the middle of the lineup that she's somebody that you circle to say, hey, if it's not gonna be Lindemann, it's gotta be Cottrell.
Chased it, and Mary Wilson Avan has her second strikeout. We welcome those of you just joining us here in Gainesville, game one of this Super Regional between the four seed, the Florida Gators, and Georgia. Courtney Lau alongside three-time All-American and national champion, Kayla Breaux. This one has been about the pitchers so far. There's so much history between these two programs. They have met a handful of times in the tournament, and now only one can advance to the Women's College World Series after this weekend.
Yeah, you're right. This is a good rivalry. Two storied programs in the SEC that have a ton of postseason experience. And like you said, it's come down to the pitching in this game. It's been really solid. We're seeing Natalie Lugo from Florida. Mary Wilson Avant is having a great start here in the bottom of the second. Mixing speeds, you can see both of them. Their changeups have been on fire. And that's what's to be expected. I mean, when you have Mary Wilson Avant in the circle for Georgia, she's their true ace. She's the one that leads them, and you need a good pitching performance from her if you want to get through Gainesville and get your way to the College World Series.
Yeah, she was the one in the circle when Georgia picked up their regular season win against the Gators. First time that Avant has had a three-ball count today. No hits in this game for either team, and now it runs full to Jamie Hoover.
Key characteristic that you're going to see with these two starting pitchers is their ability to throw the changeup in any count. Both of them have confidence in that pitch. We've seen both of these teams, especially the Gators so far, as being off balance, not really being able to time up anything, haven't hit anything solid yet, and really and truly the same goes for Georgia.
Back-to-back strikeouts for Avant, her third strikeout of the afternoon.
Ball out of the park, and they're a young team that's aggressive at the plate.
Lou Harris-Champer has put together a scrappy group, and they've had a great mindset the last few weeks. Jaden Fields, we told you, they can go yard! A leadoff home run for Jaden Fields!
Jaden Fields gets in the box, and she's ready to go on this pitch from Natalie Lugo. You can see right here, takes a little bit off of it, and Jaden Fields times it up perfectly. She's sitting on this pitch, she's ready for it, and strokes it beautifully dead center to get Georgia on the board. And this is what makes Georgia so scary, is anytime they can strike 1 through 9, they have pop in their lineup.
Yeah, just look back to their regional final. They won 10-9. I mean, it was just people slugging the softball all over the place, and Georgia wasn't afraid as Bordeaux shoots one to Lindemann at first.
And you can see Georgia right now is starting to make a few adjustments. You can tell they're a little bit more on time. Even that last line out was a loud out. It was well struck just right to somebody. And they understand their MO. They know they need to score runs to be productive. However they can help out Avant, and the circle is going to be huge for them. But specifically what impresses me about this Georgia offense is despite the fact that sometimes they're down, even if they give up runs, they know that they can score in bunches and they can score quickly.
Yeah, get this, Kayla. That was the first extra base hit that Florida has allowed since May 13th when they faced Missouri.
I mean, that shows you how lights out their pitching staff has been. Just so consistent. And what the Gators do the best is they hit the corners. They pound the edges of the strike zone. And you could see right there on that last pitch from Lugo that Jaden Fields hit out of the park. It was a miss. It was a little bit too much right over the plate.
And Georgia knew they would have to take advantage of every little miss they got because Florida has been so solid. This is the first time they've allowed a run in the tournament. We got to show you this one again from Jaden Fields.
You can see a little bit too much over the white. Jaden Fields jumps all over that. There's a slight drop in the velocity, but she's sitting on that pitch. She's sitting on that speed, and she crushes it. It was a no-doubter.
2-2 count to Ellie Armistead. Over the hand of Hannah Adams. And a couple of hits in this inning for Georgia, the first of the game for either team.
Something that Georgia has been able to do really well this season, specifically their righties, is they hit the curveball pretty well. They have a good opportunity to go oppo often because they stay in their swings. They make sure their extension goes to the opposite field. And even on that one, it's off the end of the bat for Armistead, but she'll take it because she stays through the zone long enough to pick up a single.
Top of the order, Savannah Sykes. This time with a runner on. Sykes hitting .286 with runners on base. A much different inning for Natalie Lugo. She only threw 10 pitches to Georgia in the second.
I think that's something we're going to see as this Georgia team is coming up through the lineup the second time, is what pitch do I sit on? Because Lugo has a very specific arsenal of pitches. She's throw the changeup, and you're going to see that at least once in your at-bat. So we saw Jaden Fields sit on the off-speed. That was what she wanted to look for. We saw Armistead go after the curveball. So I think as these players come up second time around, you're going to see them look for specific pitches and be a little bit more confident and have a better plan round two. And, you know, if they touch her up pretty early in this game, wouldn't be shocked if we see Elizabeth Hightower come in, try and mix things up.
Yeah, you saw her warming up in the bullpen, fresh off of a no-hitter last Sunday in the regional final. But Lugo getting the start today. And she's behind right now, 3-0. Second time that she's had a three-ball count, and they've both come against Savannah Sykes. Yeah, Sykes is smart. You got to make her throw something. Armistead on first, thanks to the single. Gets the out, but Armistead bumps over to second. She is in scoring position. Georgia led off this inning with a solo shot from Jaden Fields. And that brings us to Sydney Kuma. She's got a big bat, too. Had three home runs in one day when they played Georgia State and Miami of Ohio back in February. 14 long balls on the season.
And she had a really nice regional tournament, hitting .500 on the weekend at three RBIs. She's also one of those young players in the lineup that keeps getting better as the season progresses, keeps getting smarter at the plate, and has the potential to hit the ball out of the park as well.
Checked it, and Lindemann will make an easy out. How about this to start the third inning?
Jaden Fields sitting on what she wants and absolutely crushes this out of the park. 1-0, dogs are up.
this is the party that every player wants to be at.
It's going to be passionate softball for sure.
Back to crown a national champion for the first time since 2019.
They get to chase history here.
June 3rd is the date. Noon Eastern on ESPN. The Women's College World Series is back. Who will be there? One of these teams will be moving on to face either Texas or Oklahoma State. That game in action right now over on ESPN2. It is best 2 out of 3 here in the Super Regional round. Oklahoma got a win over Washington just a few moments ago. Game one of that series. But we've seen some upsets too, with Virginia Tech beating UCLA. FSU beat LSU, who's a better seeded team.
It's been a great run so far. Even that Oklahoma-Washington game was close. The Alabama-Kentucky game was tight again today. So I think you're at the point, 16 teams are left. There's so much parity in our sport. These are the top 16 teams in the entire country. They all deserve to be here. And it's going to come down to those last little moments. Who's going to come up with that one clutch hit that they need? Who's going to make that pitch with the bases loaded?
Well, Jaden Fields has been clutch so far for Georgia. A leadoff home run in the third. And now she's back out in right field as Mary Wilson Avant delivers to Bailey Goddard. Avant has been spectacular so far. 3 strikeouts. She has struck out the last 2 batters. Remember, she's a graduate student. Already has a job lined up for when she's done pitching. Mature and leads this Georgia defense.
Talking with Coach Baldwin about Mary Wilson Avant, it was very obvious that he sees her as playing chess instead of checkers. I mean, her mental game, her ability to move pitches, to read batters, to put balls where the batter's weaknesses are what have made her so excellent this season. And she's definitely not a thrower. She's a pure pitcher that understands what the movement and the placement means and how she's going to use that to disadvantage the hitters at the plate.
She's got wins this season over this Florida team and over Oklahoma. That'll be the first one she has walked today. But we got the chance to talk to Mary Wilson, and we asked her about her high school coach because it was Jeff Treadway, who played for the Atlanta Braves for a long time. You see them there. He's become a family friend. He's coached her older sisters. And she said he really pushed her to attack batters in high school, and that helped her get that tough mentality.
It's all about the mentality. It's about the confidence to go out there and say that my stuff is good. Yes, I have great movement. Yes, I have great spin. But the fearlessness to go compete one-on-one versus the batter and say, I'm going to do what I need to do to get you out. And then to carry that into your confidence, into your presence, into how you look in the circle, so important. And that's such a big piece of elevating your game, is getting that mental fortitude to be able to say, hey, I'm going to go out and dominate my competition each and every time I step onto the circle.
Facing number 8 hitter, Sarah Longley. Ahead 0-2. And we were asking Tim Walton about the difference in Mary Wilson Avant as he was scouting and getting ready for his team. Remember, they faced her in 2018 in the first game of the Women's College World Series. And he said the difference now is she can hit every spot with all of her pitches.
And that's a huge learning process for pitchers. Sometimes, so often, we see pitchers try and throw everything. They try and throw 5 or 6 different pitches, and they can't control them. Well, Mary Wilson Avant can throw 5 or 6 different pitches, and now she's got the precision to put them where she wants.
Strikeout number 4.
And this is where Mary Wilson Avant is so good. She's been able to strike out on a number of different pitches today. This one's her curveball, and you can see not only does it move away from Longley, but it also has some break upward. So it's not a traditional rise ball, but it's really good moving up and away. And that's where she's effective. She can hit all quadrants. She's not afraid to go inside or outside to both righties and lefties. She'll sprinkle in the changeup pretty often. And she's just really tough. When she's on, she's one of the best pitchers in the country. And like you said, has had the ability to beat teams like Florida, to beat teams like Oklahoma this season.
And I think, too, as the season has gone on, as they get the strike call, she's realized that, you know, she's not going to be perfect every pitch, but she's got her team to back her up now because they are coming through with the bats, too.
And she's resilient. I mean, I think about game one, she goes out and beats Florida, gets them again in the series for game three. And she stays out there for 8 runs.
Georgia will get one, but Goddard safe at first.
And we see multiple times this season, too, where Mary Wilson Avant will start a game. She'll come back out, and then they'll re-enter her to finish. So, again, her confidence, her resiliency is a key factor in this game. She's not going to be too upset. If she gives up a couple runs here and there, she's got to trust her offense to go support her and keep doing her thing in the circle.
Yeah, Rachel Fico is going to come out now, the pitching coach for Georgia, to talk to this infield. I mean, we saw Mary Wilson Avant did not get the start in their regional final. It was Britton Rogers, but then she came in and entered in a tough situation.
She came in a very tough situation. She reported 6 of the last 7 outs of the ballgame, was lights out, and that's exactly what you want out of your senior veteran pitcher to come in and close down a game, shut the opponent down, and get yourselves a ticket to the Super Regional weekend.
So a conversation here before facing the top of the order for the second time. It is Hannah Adams, a 368 hitter with a runner on. Adams 2-for-10 in the tournament coming into today. Doesn't have a hit just yet. Third time that Mary Wilson Avant has had a 3-ball count. Still hasn't given up a hit. Second walk of the inning. Avant walked the leadoff batter, Bailey Goddard, 2 on. First time that Florida has had a runner in scoring position. So now you get to Emily Wilkie, who played a big role for Florida in that SEC tournament. They didn't have Cottrell. She stepped up, playing in the DP role today. But she was tough in the box at the SEC tournament, drew a walk, and was hit by a pitch 4 times.
And this is something that Florida's been looking for throughout the season, is somebody to step up in that 2 spot behind Hannah Adams and before Charlotte Echols. And she fits that bill. She has quality at bats. She battles in there, and that's why she's in there.
Call that one a strike, and you can hear the Florida Gator fans not happy about it. Wow. A 5th strikeout for Mary Wilson Avant. We will talk to Florida head coach Tim Walton when we come back.
Mary Wilson Avant sets her up with the curve, or with the changeup, a little off speed right here, and then goes hard with the curve for strike 3.
Go Dawgs. Tanner Williams, get- I gotcha.
Hey, Coach Walton, you
hey,
got us too?
Us,
I gotcha, yep.
Great. 30 seconds out.
Yeah, this thing's a mess over here. It's brutal.
You're watching the NCAA Softball Super Regionals presented by Capital One here in Gainesville, Florida, in game one of this Super Regional best 2 out of 3. We're joined now by Florida head coach Tim Walton. And coach, why did you like Natalie Lugo to start this game against these Georgia hitters?
Well, with a little bit of history. She pitched really well against them in Athens. She pitched really well for us on Saturday in our region. She's got good change, which obviously that was the pitch the Fields hit out, but could change and can throw a little bit harder on their hands if we need to, but just felt like it was the right matchup.
Coach, you're seeing Mary Wilson Avant throw quite a variety of pitches. Is there anything you're telling your offense to sit on or look for when they go up to the plate?
No, not too much, Kayla. I mean, statistics don't lie. Her statistics against left-handed hitters are about 140 points, higher than they are against right-handers. She's tough on right-handers. We're figuring out why today. Got that little rise that's a little bit slower than all the other pitches, and her change is pretty good. So we just got to do a better job. Get her back in the zone. We got to do a better job. Use the whole field.
Awesome, Coach. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now, Mary Wilson Avant has looked solid. These Georgia hitters, though, it looked like they got on Lugo a little bit more. Jaden Fields led off the last inning with a home run. Ellie Armistead had a hit, the first two hits of the ball game for Georgia off of Lugo.
Yeah, they're slowly starting to chip away, make some adjustments, and I love the fact that Field sat on the changeup. You know she's going to throw it. That's such a smart move for some of these hitters. If that's the pitch that you feel confident that you can hit, you should absolutely sit it against Lugo until you get two strikes.
Lacey Fincher leading off the fourth. And Fincher had a really good regional last weekend. All these players, it's a long season. They go through ups and downs. She just felt really good. She had time to train, and that made a difference when she stepped in the box. Hopper to Eccles at third, one away. It's been crazy how many times this Florida team has faced a familiar foe, if you will. This is the sixth straight Super that the Gators have played an SEC team.
That's an incredible stat. And, it's unfortunate in some ways for the Gators because you crave in the postseason wanting to get out of your conference. You've seen these teams over and over again. You've already played Georgia 3 times, for example. You don't want to face them again. You want to face somebody new that doesn't know you. But, hey, we talked to Coach Walton about that, and he said, we just deal with it. It's normal for us now. You still got to show up and play. You got to win your regional and your super regional no matter what to get to the World Series. And oftentimes that comes with playing against the best in the country, and the SEC has some of the very best in the country year after year.
Let's say Mosley did not go on that one, so the count runs 2-1. Yeah, this is one of 3 Super Regionals that put conference teams back together. There's 2 from the SEC, and then, of course, there's 1 from the Big 12, Texas and Oklahoma State. Well, back in 2016, it was actually these 2 teams meeting, and it was crazy because a pinch hit walk-off home run from Kaylee Puailoa sent Georgia to the Women's College World Series. They upset the number 1 seed in this tournament, which was Florida.
And Florida was looking to three-peat. They had just won back-to-back national championships. Lou Hersham and her team come in, and they upset one of the biggest upsets of all time in a super regional. And that's what makes this rivalry so good, is there's moments like this. They play a lot in the postseason. They're both frequent visitors to the Women's College World Series.
And not to mention it's Georgia versus Florida.
Yeah. I mean, that's a classic SEC rivalry.
Yeah. That was that back in 2016 was just the second time, Kayla, that a 16 has eliminated a one seed. The other one was in 2010, I'm sorry to say.
I was like, don't bring it up.
Hawaii beat Alabama.
That's right.
Psst.
Yes, I know what it's like to be the number one team and get upset. It is not easy.
Well, if it's going to happen this year, Washington has got to win tomorrow and on what day is it? On Sunday. Yep.
Yep.
It's been a wild ride.
And they got a big game this weekend tomorrow. It's going to be on ABC, 3 Eastern.
Yes.
That's a huge deal.
Yeah, first time that softball is on ABC. We could not be more excited. Oklahoma took the win in game one today, 4-2. Lugo in front of Jada Kearney. Back to Lugo. Just a 12-pitch inning for Florida. We will talk to Lou Harris-Champer when we come back. Her Dogs up by one. Hey, Coach, can you hear us okay?
Here we go there, Will.
Hey, Coach, you got us?
Welcome back to the NCAA Softball Super Regionals presented by Capital One. Game one of the Super Regional here in Gainesville, Florida, and Georgia has a 1-0 lead on the Gators. It is best 2 out of 3, and the winner will move on to the Women's College World Series that starts next week. They'll get either Texas or Oklahoma State. Game one of that series right now over on ESPN2. Well, Georgia has sent out Mary Wilson Avant to the circle. And she has looked really solid. She already has 5 strikeouts in this game, and these Florida hitters are having a hard time adjusting.
We haven't seen Florida put really one hard ball into play today. They haven't stroked it really well to say, hey, I'm getting on time, all barrel. And that's credit to Mary Wilson Avant, what she's been able to do. Talk about a deceptive speed change. She's got a great changeup. That rise ball comes in a little bit slower than the rest of her pitches, and then she's able to hit the corners. And Mary Wilson Avant has been doing this all season long. She's so skilled. She's so strong. See right there, boom, drop ball. Then she goes inside. And then she can break it away with that curve ball. And she can just blow it by you, too. Good velocity, good movement, good late break that makes her really effective.
She hasn't thrown more than 16 pitches in an inning today. She did walk 2 batters in the third. But Florida hasn't been able to make contact. They will start off with Sharla Eccles. Second time she has seen Mary Wilson Avant is on a 9-game hit streak. This could be a great way to bust out of this because Eccles is electric at the plate.
What a good opportunity for the Gators to be able to get themselves to start off an inning fresh. Sharla Eccles is who you want up to the plate. And it's because she's just so simple. Her swing is just clean, it's crisp, and it's consistent. And she honestly reminds me of somebody like a Bailey Hemphill. And we've credited these two hitters so often this season for having really unslumpable swings. And it's because they understand barrel control. And they understand that simple sometimes is better. You can see right here, Charlotte Eccles has a beautiful, clean, tight swing. Look how fast her hands are. Look how efficient her barrel is getting to the ball and getting through the zone. She generates a ton of power very, very quickly, and it's because she's not trying to do too much in the box.
Sykes has to leap up in the air to get it, and what a stretch by Lacey Fincher to pick up the out. Georgia's defense looking solid today. We've mentioned there have been some ups and downs for these Bulldogs in the field, but today looked pretty good behind Mary Wilson.
Yeah, so far they've been really clean.
This is Kendall Lindemann. And when we talked to Tim Walton, you heard him say it's been a struggle for the right-handed hitters against Mary Wilson Avan.
Yeah, she's been dominating right-handed hitters all day. And Coach Walton talked about this discrepancy in batting average of right-handers to left-handers. And the biggest key for me is I think that curveball away from right-handers really does a great job having late bite, late movement. And this will try and go squeeze one on the inside corner to righties, but it's that curveball to righties that is really tough to get to.
Three balls and a strike to Lindemann. There's a hit. The first one today for Florida. Lindemann looking for two. We'll get it. Kendall Lindemann busting out.
Kendall Lindemann, such a veteran hitter, understands her role in this lineup. Second time around, gets something high and inside, makes an adjustment, stays on plane, and just ropes this down the left field line to pick up a nice double. And it's no surprise here who's going to break up the opportunity, who's going to break up the no-no. It's got to be Kendall Lindemann. And the reason is because she's so mature at the plate. She knows what it takes to be a good hitter. She's played at Minnesota and now Florida and has the ability to make quality adjustments at the plate, stayed really level in that swing, and picks up a nice opportunity for the Gators.
Yeah, a three-time All-American, and now she's in scoring position for Julia Cottrell, who struck out the first time against Mary Wilson Avant. And, you know, we talked to Kendall Lindemann because she is one of the veterans on this team, as you mentioned. And she said, I talked to the team about nerves before the SEC tournament. Yeah, it's fine to have them before, but when that first pitch is thrown, you've got to shake them off and be ready. And she just set a great example for Florida.
And that's something else. It's so unexpected when you hear statistics like this, but this is a young Florida team as well. We talk about how young the Georgia team is. Florida's young. They have a lot of inexperience because of that COVID year, because of the timing of everything. They have some players that are new to Super Regional experience.
Yeah, and Julia Cottrell is one of them. Just a sophomore, had that shortened season last year. She did start every game last year and has started the majority of this year, but her first Super.
And this is a tough environment to play in.
Just foul. Look, Julia Cottrell, she may not have played in a Super, but she's seen it. Her dad, Jeff, is an assistant coach at Oklahoma State. Now, keep in mind, they're in action right now. And if they advance and Florida advances, they would meet in game one of the Super, of the Women's College World Series next week. strikeout. Cottrell goes down swinging. Mary Wilson has gotten to these Florida hitters.
Goes with the drop ball. Look at the break on that. It looks like it's going to hang right at the knees, and at the last second, falls right to the ankles of Cottrell. She's off balance. She's out in front. And Avant gets the best of her in that at bat.
All six strikeouts by Mary Wilson. Avant have been swinging today. Jamie Hoover plus one to Kuma. And Florida is going to leave a runner in scoring position. Kendall Lindemann gets the first hit on the board, but she gets stuck. Well, coming up tomorrow, Saturday at 3 Eastern over on ABC, we will get to see Oklahoma and Washington battle. How fun will that be? The very first time that we will have softball on ABC. And it was Oklahoma today getting the win 4-2. Jocelyn Allo had another home run to help the Sooners get the job done.
Man, that Sooners offense is just something that you love to watch if you like hitting. And the reason is that they all look like professionals up there. I mean, they are so good 1-9, and even off the bench, they have some really good power hitters off the bench. But their approach, their mentality, their aggressiveness, I mean, we saw it last weekend, Courtney. They are unreal. Go watch them.
Yeah, 50 runs on the board last weekend in their regional, 12 home runs. In the seventh inning of their regional final, they scored 10 runs and hit 4 home runs.
And two of my favorite players to watch on that team are the two freshmen, T.R.A. Jennings and Jada Coleman. Both of them just look so mature beyond their years. They play such a pivotal role for the offense. You have T.R.A. Jennings, who's in the leadoff spot. That's this calm, consistent presence. And then you have Jada Coleman coming up in the middle. That is a firecracker, somebody that you just love to watch play because of her energy out on the field.
Yeah, both finalists for the National Freshman of the Year. I loved watching T.R.A. Jennings. It was crazy how good she is at the plate.
Yeah, and they've got some crazy pop in their bat too. I mean, just 1-9, you cannot take a break if you are a pitcher against that team. I can't even imagine what it would feel like to go out in the circle and face them.
I'd say it's 1-the team because you can pull a pinch, you could put a pinch hitter in and gone.
That's so true.
This is Sydney Chambly up. And she will walk. You know, we wondered how Oklahoma would fare against better pitching, and they saw that today with Gabby Plain in the circle. Because that's been the question for Oklahoma, is their schedule wasn't super tough, and they've put up a ton of runs, but I was interested to see how they did against Plain.
I got to be honest with you. If you're Washington and you went into that game knowing that Gabby Plain only gave up 4 runs, that's a winnable game for the Huskies. That's kind of what you imagine being the threshold. Okay, we have to put up at least 4 or 5 to be able to beat the Sooners. You're just not going to score less and win. Perfect example, early in the year when Georgia played Oklahoma. I mean, it was a high-scoring, big-time home run, a lot of production ball game. It wasn't a 2-1 pitcher's duel. It was a home run fest.
Jaden Fields was big in that Oklahoma game. She has been big in this game. She's the reason that Georgia is up 1-0, led off the third inning with a home run. And I love the response, too. We have seen her come in as a sub, especially last weekend. Today she gets the start, and boom, gone. Second hit of the game for Jaden Fields.
You know, sometimes you just get a feeling as a coach, whose time is it, who's going to do well? And today it was Jaden Fields' turn. She sits on the changeup on her first at-bat, hits one out of the park, and then gets a little curveball in the outside corner and does a beautiful job of keeping it simple, spraying it to the opposite field. I mean, she's got a really nice swing. She does a great job of controlling that barrel and puts a runner in a scoring position for Georgia with no outs.
Peyton Bordeaux. It's going to drop. And that loads the bases. Just popped up on the first pitch and somehow found the room.
Yeah, this is a little jam sandwich. Bordeaux in on the hands, finds a way to muscle it out, and it just falls perfectly in between left, center, and the shortstop position. And all of a sudden, here we go. Bulldogs, bases loaded, no outs, trying to get something going and have an opportunity to put a big exclamation point on this ball game.
It'll be Ellie Armistead, the number nine hitter, up with the bases loaded. Already has a hit off of Lugo.
And we gotta give credit here. The bottom of the lineup has done so well for Georgia today. Obviously, you have a 7-8-9 home run from Jaden Fields, a base hit from Armistead, and then 2 base hits once again from Jaden Fields and Peyton Bordeaux.
Eccles throwing home, looking for 2. Tag is applied! Sarah Longley got over there, made the tag, and Florida gets 2.
The Florida defense is always ready to go. They don't panic. Eccles makes this play look easy. It's a hard hit off the bat of Armistead. She makes a beautiful throw to Cottrell at home, and then Cottrell sees an opportunity to get the out of third. Longley doesn't panic, stays with the ball, and as Jaden Fields comes off the base, she's able to get the second out of the inning.
That's what we're talking about. This Florida defense makes incredible plays. And Sharla Eccles told Tim Walton when she came to Florida, I don't want to be a catcher center field. I want to play on the infield. And she loves third base.
Yeah, and that's a huge miscue for Georgia. Jaden Fields lets her momentum take her off third base. And all of a sudden, you go from one out, bases loaded, to 2 outs at runner on second and first. But that's what it's all about for defense and Sharla Eccles and Sarah Longley at shortstop is capitalizing when the other team makes a base running error. You take advantage and you get them out. I got to be honest, too. I thought it was an interesting call for Cottrell to go home to third and try and get the force out over at third instead of going to first. I think she would have had more time. It would have been an easier play. But nonetheless, the defense steps up and gets the out anyway.
Now it's a ball and a strike to Savannah Sykes. Sykes has not reached tonight. Scoop locked up. Cheyenne Lindsay. Gators defense, though, chomp, chomp.
Gators have one of the best defenses in the entire country, and they show it off right here. Eccles to Cottrell to Longley, off the base and out of the inning.
Ladies, thank you. Allison Fiebre, former Georgia Bulldog. That we're keeping an eye on that Super Regional, because the winner of this Super Regional will go on to face either Oklahoma State or Texas. Whoever wins that series, they will see that team first in the Women's College World Series that starts next week. Bailey Goddard leading off. Things get even a little spicier, too, if you're Florida, because Florida's catcher, Julia Cottrell, her dad is an assistant at Oklahoma State. How fun would that be?
Yeah, a little father-daughter rivalry heading into the World Series would be interesting to see.
Obviously, he didn't see it, but Cottrell was a part of that double play because he's coaching in a game right now. But Julia yeah. just helped them turn that double play. Here they are. Remember, Oklahoma State beat Florida State in 2019 to advance to the Women's College World Series. Julia went with her dad. She did say she wore white to be neutral. Was committed to Florida, but hadn't played for them yet. And Mary Wilson gets her seventh strikeout today. But what an addition Cottrell has been for Florida. And that last inning could be crucial for Georgia moving forward. They had the bases loaded.
It could be a really big factor in this ball game. One run lead isn't enough against the Gators. And Mary Wilson Avent is pitching excellent right now. But that was an opportunity for Georgia. And it was a really strange play. But unfortunately, you can't make that mistake and run yourselves out of an inning to give up that opportunity. And Georgia did that to himself. And it's a situation they're going to want back later on. And because of that, next play is a fly ball to the outfield. That is out number three. That might be a sac fly.
Sarah. Sarah Longley up now, ahead on Avant 2-0. Yeah, the game that Georgia won in the regular season against Florida, it was 4-2. Mary Wilson Avant threw a one-hitter in that game. She's only given up one hit so far. It was a double to Kendall Lindemann, but she got stuck at second.
Yeah, Mary Wilson Avant game one is so fresh today. She proved that in the regular season. She's so tough when you've only seen her a couple times. Florida made some really good adjustments and were more effective against her later in the series. And the other thing that I look at is Mary Wilson Avant plays such an important factor because in game two, where she did not pitch, Florida scored 17 runs on Georgia. They threw six different pitchers and they gave up 17 runs. That's a lot.
In that series as a whole, Florida outscored Georgia 27-6 during the regular season as Merrick Wilson gets back-to-back Ks.
Gets a K looking here. It's a little backdoor curve right at the belt. Gets a Longley was just perplexed. Didn't really know what she was looking for. Wasn't ready to battle with two strikes and takes a walk back to the dugout because of it.
Center second hit for Georgia, for Florida, excuse me, off of Georgia.
And this is a really important hit. The bottom of the lineup has got to come through for Florida. And thus far, the bottom of the lineup has been 0-for with one walk and seven strikeouts until that Cheyenne Lindsay hit. And what that does is it turns the lineup over so Hannah Adams, who has home run potential, who has high average potential, is up at the plate.
Adams has reached once today on a walk. Remembers this Georgia team well. Her first career game at the Women's College World Series was against Georgia. They run-ruled the Bulldogs. That was against Mary Wilson Avant. Cheyenne Lindsley at first. Lindsay at first. She is their stolen base leader, but you got to be careful. Two outs. The extra hustle from Sydney Chambly, and for the second time, Florida will strand a runner. They're down one. Georgia's in the lead thanks to the long ball. Back in the third inning, Jaden Fields leading off with a solo shot out to center field. It's been the difference so far in this game. That combines with some great pitching.
Mary Wilson Avent has been on fire today, doing an excellent job of mixing speeds and spins. She is perplexing this Gator offense, and her ability to go out and command her pitches is why she has given up only two hits today and given up zero runs.
Florida has given up four hits. Keep in mind, in their entire regional, all three games combined, they only allowed three hits, and today Georgia's bats in tune, given up four. Natalie Lugo getting the start, still in the circle here in the sixth inning, and we'll start off with Sydney Kuma. Georgia had a huge opportunity to extend this lead, and a one-run lead against Florida is scary because we've seen them just four walk-offs in this month of May alone. But they had the opportunity in the fifth, had the bases loaded, and Florida turned a double play for the 27th time this season. Kuma, no problem for Adams. One away. We'll have a trio of NBA playoff game threes for you coming up tonight. We'll start in the ATL with the Knicks and the Hawks at 7 Eastern on ESPN. The Nets and the Celtics are on ABC at 8:30 Eastern. And then we cap the night with Clippers-Mavs at 9:30 Eastern on ESPN. And, of course, all three games available on the ESPN app so you don't miss a single possession. Lacey Fincher to Eccles. That was quick. Two down now. And reminder, too, all of these Super Regionals, you can take them with you, streaming live on the ESPN app. It's great. Every game has its own window. Of course, we're going to see Oklahoma and Washington on ABC tomorrow at 3 Eastern. The first time we've had softball on ABC.
We've already seen some great storylines. Virginia Tech upsetting UCLA in game one, so that's going to be a great game two tonight.
Sarah Mosley, a quick inning for this Florida defense. They got to get the bats going. They're down by one. Super Regionals, it's a rivalry too. Makes it even more exciting. The fifth time these two teams have met in the postseason. The last time was in 2018 in the World Series. Florida defeated Georgia, but in supers? Last time was 2016, and it was Georgia walking off in game two with a pinch hit home run to send Florida home and Georgia to Oklahoma City. Courtney Lyle, Caleb Rowe with you. Mary Wilson Avant has been fantastic. I don't know what else you can say about how solid she's been.
I mean, she's been so efficient too. Only 73 pitches so far in the game. That just tells me that she has been really, really strong with her command. She's attacking hitters like we talked about earlier. And with the exception of a couple hits for Florida, I mean, she's really made very, very few mistakes. She's induced easy outs for her defense, which is so important with a young defense playing behind you.
Eight strikeouts on the afternoon for Avant. Emily Wilkie skies it. Armistead calling everybody off. One away. Any adjustments that stand out for Florida? I mean,
I think this is the biggest challenge is that, you know, we've seen her really mix it up. She's not getting into patterns. She's not throwing the same thing to every batter. She's really trying to pinpoint their mistakes. And a lot of their swings are on the big K, swings and misses, or miss hits. We've seen a lot of pop outs, a lot of easy ground ball outs. So the timing has just not been there. And I think about the couple good hits on the day so far. I think about Kendall Lindemann getting something inside a little bit elevated, and she turns on it and crushes it.
And obviously any rally caps and rally visors that Florida can get right now,
that's
they're
right.
gonna take. The Twizzler is key on the towel. That's key.
Obviously, why wouldn't you put a Twizzler on there?
I wore that this morning. Charlotte Echols looking for her first hit. She came in on a 9-game hit streak. Lines one to Armistead. Two down.
And that's the best piece of hitting that we've seen from Echols today. Goes right to Armistead. And sometimes just how this game goes, you hit something hard. Armistead playing a little bit up the middle is in the right place at the right time for the second out of the inning. And Avant continues to cruise.
Kendall Lindemann, she had the double. That was the first hit that Florida got off of Mary Wilson Avant today.
Something really important too, we talked to Coach Baldwin, the assistant coach for Georgia, before this ball game. If you have the chance, if you have an opportunity to walk Lindemann and Echols, will you? They haven't needed to today. There's been nobody on base in front of them throughout this ball game. And that makes a huge difference that you can go be fearless and pitch to the best hitters in the lineup without the risk of a 2 or 3 run home run.
Ooh, strike two.
This is a beautiful pitch right here. Avant, changeup, pulling the string. And Lindemann's not sitting on it. That's a really good location. It's low in the zone. And that's a nice strike. And again, last at bat, Lindemann strokes a high pitch down the line. So what do? You go with the off speed, try and keep her off balance and keep her guessing.
2-2 to Lindemann. She does it again. It's fair. Kendall Lindemann. It rolls to the corner, and she has her second double of the evening.
Well, this is the kind of intelligence that Kendall Lindemann has, because she gets a similar pitch and off speed once again, same changeup, same location, and this time she's ready for it. She sits on it with two strikes, barely gets it down the line and fair. And for the second time today, Kendall Lindemann standing on two with a double.
Ninth double on the season, the second one that Lindemann has had tonight. And now Julia Cottrell is up. She was not able to help out Lindemann. She has struck out twice, and there'll be a pinch runner for Florida. Callie Reese, and you see Kendall Lindemann immediately communicating with Julia Cottrell.
And that right there's the veteran and the experience that Kendall Lindemann brings. She's going and talking to a player, her teammate that doesn't have postseason experience, making sure she communicates effectively what the pitcher's throwing, but also giving her confidence, saying, hey, you got this. I believe in you. You can go out and do this right now.
Yeah, Lindeman 2-for-3. The rest of Florida 1-for-17. She knows how to hit a vamp. James on the first pitch. Armistead, yes. And Florida will leave a runner in scoring position again. Georgia on top by one.
The NCAA Softball Super Regionals is presented by Capital One. What's in your wallet?
You're watching the NCAA Softball Super Regionals presented by Capital One. Two teams battling for a spot in Oklahoma City. We've got game one of this best of three series here in Gainesville, Texas, and Oklahoma State. That's currently on ESPN2. These two teams, one of them will get the winner of that series. And the difference has been Jaden Fields, a solo home run, but the only run on the board. And Mary Wilson Avant has been fantastic in the circle. Natalie Lugo heating up, though. She only threw 5 pitches in the last inning.
I was going to say, really, too, Natalie Lugo has been fantastic also. If you're only giving up one run to this potent Georgia offense, you're doing a good job out there. And really, truly, she's made one mistake. And you have to give credit to Jaden Fields. She sat on your best pitch, and sometimes you just got to tip your cap on that one pitch. But beyond that, her defense has helped her out, coming up with a big-time play with the bases loaded to help her get out of a jam.
Yeah, they turned a double play in the 5th inning. She's only walked one batter, struck out 3. Sydney Chambly up at the plate right now. Chambly swung a nice bat in the regional for Georgia, drove in the game-winning run in the bottom of the 6th inning in that regional final against Duke. Remember, Georgia was hosting, but Duke was the seeded team, and they were knocked out by these Dogs. Chambly will walk. I mean, this game, one of the supers, is so important. Just look at the percentages right now, because if you come out and you're able to win game one, history shows 81% of the time you're moving on to the Women's College World Series.
It's a crazy statistic, and it is so hard for teams to come back after dropping game one. It takes a lot of momentum. It's taxing. Your backs are against the wall. It's a lot of pressure to know that if we lose, we're done. And a lot of teams don't handle that really well.
The only run on the board was from the bat of Jaden Fields. Georgia, by the way, 23-0 when leading after five innings.
No, I look at that stat and I think, wow, Georgia is so strong at the end. But then I look at the opposite and how strong Florida is to be able to come back and win games. I mean, 1-0, anything is possible, obviously. And with the way the Gators have been able to come back and have 8 walk-off victories this season, that is a scary fact right there for the Bulldogs.
Pitch well inside. Ball and 2 strikes to Fields. Both runners safe. Sarah Longley was having to run and throw back as her momentum was carrying her forward. That's tough.
Yeah, Longley had no chance on that one, especially because she was shifted up the middle a little bit because of Armistead being at first base. She's had a little different defensive shift on, and that slow roller in the 5-6 hole is just not going to have the time to make that play in this game.
So Lou Harris-Champer calls her runners over. Peyton Bordeaux, it will be the one up at the plate next. Georgia had an opportunity to put some more runs on the board in the fifth, had the bases loaded. This Florida defense turned an amazing double play to give them some momentum.
And really, that's been the key for Florida. We talk about their ability to be to win games late, and it's because of their defense keeps them in games. And that's something that this team recognizes, is that they have a skill set defensively that is one of the best in the country. And if they step up and do their jobs, their offense will have a shot.
Bordeaux picked up her first hit in the tournament in the fifth inning. She was 0-for-7 in regionals. Just a freshman, a true freshman. She didn't get the shortened season last year with Georgia. Had to step into the catching duties when Jessica Morgan was out with an injury. Morgan has been her biggest cheerleader, though. That's really helped her take over this role behind the plate.
And being catcher is so important. And to get that experience as a true freshman to come in and control the pace of the game, control your defense, but also because of her skill behind the plate and the necessity for a catcher, she's gotten a ton more at-bats and getting a ton experience offensively that's going to pay dividends down the road as her career continues.
3 balls and a strike to Bordeaux with 2 on. A walk and a single is how Georgia put 2 on base. Eccles diving into the dugout. Wow, she almost had that in her glove.
What a beautiful effort from Eccles over at third base, doing her best to get over and make this play. But you can tell just hitting that netting and falling into the dugout makes the ball pop out at the last second, not able to hang on to it.
Full count to Bordeaux. Left field. Over the fence! Peyton Bordeaux goes yard, just the 4th home run for her on the season.
Again and again, Natalie Lugo challenged the freshman on the inside corner of the plate, but the freshman comes back and makes an adjustment. tries to go tight end, little backdoor curveball. Peyton Bordeaux takes this thing for a ride. He just lines it out over the fence to give Georgia the 4-run lead in the top of the seventh inning. Talk about clutch for your team and being able to score quickly. The Georgia Bulldogs are so dangerous because of their home run ability.
We've seen it time and time again. Remember, this is a Georgia team. They trailed by 7 runs to Kentucky in the regular season. Bounced back, got a 3-run homer from Sarah Mosley. I mean, anybody can do it in this lineup. And you see the savage chain around Peyton Bordeaux's neck. They get that for home runs.
And they went toe-to-toe with the Oklahoma Sooners as well. I can't help but go back to that game. You talk about moments and games during the season that give you confidence and let you know that you can beat anybody, anytime, anywhere. That's one of them right there. You go beat the Sooners, you out-hit the Sooners, so you know when you go to Gainesville for a Super Regional that you can hit their pitching.
Now, Oklahoma had won 40 straight before facing Georgia. Ellie Armistead's got a 3-0 count. Second walk this inning.
You know, you look at this ball game too, and I can't help but go to the bottom of the lineups for both of these teams. And Georgia's bottom of the lineup came to play. Sydney Chambly gets on with a couple walks. Jaden Fields, 2 hits and a home run. Peyton Bordeaux, 1 hit and another home run. And then you have Ellie Armistead, who comes out with a hit and then gets a walk right there. The bottom of their lineup was so productive today, and that's the difference, because you look at Florida right now, on the other side, bottom of the lineup, 1 hit, 5 Ks.
Wow. Top of the order is Savannah Sykes, and she has Ellie Armistead on thanks to that walk. Well, Tony Baldwin told us, the associate head coach for Georgia, they've won games in so many different ways. It's been different people stepping up. You saw it last weekend in those games that they played in the regional, and he liked that coming in to a grinding series with Florida.
No, you're so right. There's so many moments where you look for your team just to understand how to win ball games. The regional is a great example of that. You win a 1-0 ball game tight against Duke in game 1, and then you win a 10-9 ball game when you face them again to move on to Super Regionals.
And we're going to have a pitching change for Florida as Natalie Lugo will come out. Giving up a couple of home runs, the last being a 3-run shot to Peyton Bordeaux, and Georgia is up 4-0 here in game 1 of this Super Regional. Riley Trilicek will be in the circle for Florida. We'll show you what she's got when we come back to Gainesville. New pitcher in the circle, Riley Trilicek, comes in for the first time since May 1st against Missouri. We'll see her here against Savannah Sykes.
Yeah, the Gators make no mistake by putting Hightower in. There's no point in getting your ace in the circle in this game. And really for Trilicek, it's just going to come down to keeping the score the same. You have such a tough challenge if you're the Florida Gators to face Mary Wilson Avant in the bottom half of this inning to try and scratch away at this lead from Georgia. especially with the way that Avant has just been able to shut down this Gators offense with the exception of Kendall Lindemann.
So Trilichek will inherit two balls to Savannah Sykes. Natalie Lugo had thrown six straight balls, and then Tim Walton made the change here to Trilichek. Runner on first via the walk. Georgia has keyed in this inning. They started out, got a walk from Sydney Chambly, a single from Jaden Fields, her third hit of the day. That ties a career high for her. And then a three-run homer by Peyton Bordeaux. Georgia has struggled, has been the top of the lineup, like you mentioned, Kayla. 7-8-9 in the lineup, they're 6-for-8. The rest of the Bulldogs hitting 0-for-16. Remember, Savannah Sykes hits in that top spot. Gators looking for two. You bet. Second time Florida has turned a double play. The Gators will have to do what they do. Walk it off when we come back, because Georgia's gone yard.
Bordeaux putting an exclamation point into this swing, giving Georgia the big lead heading to the bottom of the seventh.
Georgia loves to swing for the fences, and that has been the difference. Jaden Field led off the third with a solo shot, and then Peyton Bordeaux, just her fourth home run of the season.
You gotta love to see Georgia Bulldogs put insurance runs on the board. You know how good Florida is late in the ball game, so what do? You make sure you give Mary Wilson Avant some run support, and you do it the best way you know how with home run ball, which you've been dominating here in the postseason.
Eight home runs in this tournament for Georgia. Remember, they came in having lost their last seven games, hit the NCAA tournament, went 3-0 last weekend, took down a seeded team, and they're three outs away from getting a win over Florida.
It's big time. Nobody's saving this tournament. We've already seen a couple upsets, and this will be the first time that we see an unseeded team get a victory so far in the NCAA tournament super regional weekend.
So it will be the 6, 7, and 8 hitters. Jamie Hoover starting off. Hits have been at a premium today for Florida. Mary Wilson Avant has only given up 3 hits. 2 of those were 2 doubles to Kendall Lindemann, but they left her on base.
And really, this is a big moment for the Gators. Not only are you trying to chip away and come back in this ballgame, but without a doubt, you're going to see Alien again this weekend. So if you can pick something up, have a quality at bat, see something, pick up a pitch that you want to sit on for potentially tomorrow or Sunday's game, then you need to do that.
And Florida has seen that before. Remember, in the regular season series, Mary Wilson Avant was fantastic in game one against them, but they did pick out something. They were able to make the adjustments, so when they saw her again in game three, they put 8 runs on the board. You know, there's the difference from game one, just allowing one hit in the regular season series. Game three, Florida had 7 hits, scored 8 runs.
The other number that I look up is the 6 walks compared to the 3. Really working the free passes, having more quality at bats. And if you can't find ways to really hit a pitcher hard, find ways to foul pitches off and get to advantageous counts so that you can potentially pick up that free pass.
Strikeout number 9 by Avant.
Beautiful pitch right here for Avant. Goes with the drop ball. We've seen her throw this a few times today, but you can see right there the little late break. Tons of spin, tons of rotation on this pitch that caused Hoover to swing over the top of it for the first out of the inning.
Now 8 of those 9 strikeouts have been swinging by Avant, and we're going to see a pinch hitter come in. Avery Gels. Hitting 234 on the season. Last time we saw her was in that SEC tournament final against Alabama. She was 0-for-1 as a pinch hitter. One count. Avant's going to get over there for out number 2. Wow, she has been so good
in fielding her position. I mean, she has had one of her best performances of the entire season today against the Gators. She's dominated them in every single capacity. She has high strikeout numbers, really incredible movement, and it's no doubt that she's going to be the player of the game.
Yeah, that is tonight's Capital One player of the game. 3-hit shutout through 6 2/3, 9 strikeouts. Her season high strikeouts, by the way, is 12. Obviously can't get there in this one, but an outstanding performance.
And the other thing I look at too is that she's only at 95 pitches, and we've seen her throw up to 150 pitches this season, so she's not going to be too taxed to be able to throw tomorrow.
Now this is Jordan Matthews pinch hitting. Yeah, do you throw her again tomorrow?
Yeah, I would. I think she's your best chance. I think that Florida has not proved that they can hit her consistently enough. And if she looks anything tomorrow like she does today, she's going to give the opportunity for Georgia to try and punch their ticket to Oklahoma City and keep the Bulldogs in the game. It's going to require some changes and some adjustments from this Florida offense if they want to beat her in this series.
Gators down to their last strike.
Go, 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 go.
Sykes on the move into the netting. Two balls, two strikes to Jordan Matthews. This will be the seventh pitch to Matthews, up next from Avant. Count runs full. Florida hitters have struggled to get on time with Mary Wilson Avant tonight, down to their final strike.
Matthews continues to battle, putting together a really good at-bat. This is what you want if you're the Gators. You get a pinch hitter in. That is a tough out right here. That's making Mary Wilson Avant just work and continue to work as this game is reaching its end and onto the last out. Anything that you can do to help yourself out for tomorrow matters.
Back to Avant. The home run hitting Bulldogs have taken down Florida in Gainesville and got a gem of a performance from Mary Wilson Avant.
Mary Wilson Avant was lights out today. She brought it. The veteran came in dealing, ready to go. You come into a hostile environment playing the number four team in the country, and she looked so comfortable, so consistent, and she dominated from the first inning to the last.
Georgia one win away from advancing to the Women's College World Series for the fifth time. They would face either Texas or Oklahoma State. What a performance it was. Home runs from Jaden Fields and a three-run shot from Peyton Bordeaux. Game two of this series will be tomorrow at noon Eastern on ESPN. A Georgia win moves them on to Oklahoma City.
Yep, she's coming.
Oh, yep, there she is.
Okay. Okay.
They have no errors today.
Yeah, he's got me. He already got me.
Mary Wilson Avan in the circle for Georgia today as the Bulldogs get the win over Florida in game one, 4-0. And Mary Wilson, you were fantastic. What was working today against these talented Gator hitters?
Yeah, I really think my changeup was a difference maker today. I was able to keep it low for the most part, and it helped my other pitches be more effective.
Mary, you came into today and you needed some support from your defense and you got it. How have you seen your team grow from a defensive perspective this season?
Yeah, honestly, even in this past, 3 weeks, we have grown tremendously, both in our skills on the field and in our mindset when we're playing and when we're in the field. We have worked a lot on little fundamental things, just trying to make those things simple so we can make the plays in the game. And that's what we've been doing, and I'm just so proud of the defense.
Yeah, Mary Wilson, we got to see, I mean, everybody on this team can step up offensively, but how about your catcher, Peyton Bordeaux, the freshman? It was her fourth home run of the season. What was it like for you to see her come up clutch?
She's such a stud, not only behind the plate, but it's so fun to see her just kind of blossom in the batter's box as well.
Mary, if you get the opportunity to pitch tomorrow, would you take the ball in the circle?
Absolutely, 100%.
Fantastic. Mary Wilson, we will see you on Saturday and game one of the series going to Georgia.
So
If I'm watching this tournament and I haven't played yet and I'm one of the teams that's still around, man, you gotta be on upset alert. You gotta be ready to go. We've seen two upsets, FSU over LSU and obviously Virginia Tech over UCLA so far.
And we do want to let you know, too, Oklahoma won their first game just moments ago against Washington 4-2. So not the 24-7 slugfest that we saw in the regional final, but Oklahoma still getting the win. This will be Sarah Mosley leading off for Georgia. Natalie Lugo and her defense took care of Georgia 1-2-3, ending with a strikeout. Lugo getting the start over Elizabeth Hightower, who had a no-hitter in the regional final against USF on Sunday. Florida's pitching and defense have been so solid, but you've got to know in the back of their mind they're thinking about every single one of these Georgia hitters, especially Sarah Mosley. She might be the definition of clutch.
Oh, without a doubt. She's had some incredibly big hits this season. Whether it's a home run or a single, whatever it may be, you just feel like when she's playing some of the toughest competition, she elevates her game. And her teammates recognize that. We got to talk to some of these Georgia players and ask about Sarah Mosley, and they're like, oh man, we know she's gonna get it done. And even when she's on deck, she'll be like, hey, don't worry, I got you. I got this, yep. I'm gonna get it.
Oh, she'll have to wait though. That's back-to-back strikeouts for Natalie Lugo.
Not only is it back-to-back strikeouts, but this is her second strikeout in a row looking and gets them a little curveball in the outside corner. Beautiful location, just freezes up Sarah Mosley on that one. Off to a really great start.
Jada Kearney, the center fielder, steps in now. What makes Lugo a better matchup for Georgia?
Yeah, I think it's her ability to really mix speeds. And we talk about Hightower mixes speeds too, but Lugo's got that changeup that is so nasty, that drops a ton in velocity. And that sometimes is the equalizer between a home run hitting team, is having the ability to go with that pitch that's going to buckle up the knees, that you can throw for a strike, that when they're down in the count, they're going to have to hit that pitch or try and foul that pitch off.
Now, the last time we saw Lugo was against South Alabama last weekend, had 11 strikeouts, only gave up two hits. All the way down to first, and Kendall Lindemann.
That was a really nice pitch sequence there by Lugo to be able to hit the corner for a strike looking and then work it out a couple more inches so you induce an easy ground ball for your defense. And that's something else that we talked to this pitching staff about, is they don't have to go out and strike everybody out. They trust their defense.
Sydney Chambly takes the first pitch. It's in foul territory, and it'll be scooped up by Sarah Langley. That was a quick inning for Georgia. Lugo rocking.
Ripped in the air to center field. Back at the wall.
Walk-off style against Texas A&M. It just feels like they have their number.
High drive. Deep left.
A two-run walk-off shot.
Florida will be the one seed in the SEC tournament.
Adams, the walk-off RBI double. Eighth walk-off for the Gators this year.
And four of those walk-offs have been in the month of May. This Florida team has been clutch. They've got their walk-off walk down pat. They are dangerous all the way through the seventh.
You know, when I look at that, and the reason for their ability to hit those walk-offs is because they don't panic. They know who they are. They take care of business early in the game. They trust their pitching staff. They trust their defense. And they know if there's outs left on the board, they've got a shot. And that belief has created that huge string of walk-offs, this huge string of comeback wins this season.
Kendall Lindemann will lead off this inning for Florida. It was a 1-2-3 inning in the first. Lindemann coming in on a 6-game hit streak. She has reached base last 11 games. Stays fair. And Savannah Sykes makes the play. Well, the Women's College World Series returns to Oklahoma City. The action begins Thursday, June 3rd at noon Eastern, live on ESPN. For more information on the 2021 Women's College World Series, go to NCAA.com, the official online home for all 90 NCAA championships. Both of these programs have been to OKC before. For Georgia, the last time was 2018. For Florida, the last time, of course, 2019. They have been there the last three Women's College World Series. You know, you mentioned walk-offs. Julia Cottrell had a big one against Texas A&M.
And she's such an important factor for this team because so often throughout this season, we've heard so much about Kendall Lindemann, Charlotte Echols, Hannah Adams, and who else in the lineup would have the ability to step up? Well, Cottrell, especially during the middle of the season in SEC play, was really the one that stepped up, and that's the reason that she's hitting behind Kendall Lindemann in the lineup. And they missed her for the SEC tournament. She wasn't able to travel with them, and having her back is a huge deal. Coach Walton said he felt the difference. He felt her absence. And she plays such a key role in the middle of the lineup that she's somebody that you circle to say, hey, if it's not going to be Lindemann, it's got to be Cottrell.
Chased it, and Mary Wilson Avan has her second strikeout. We welcome those of you just joining us here in Gainesville. Game one of this Super Regional between the four seed, the Florida Gators, and Georgia. Courtney Lyle alongside three-time All-American and national champion Kayla Breaux. This one has been about the pitchers so far. There's so much history between these two programs. They have met a handful of times in the tournament, and now only one can advance to the Women's College World Series after this weekend.
Yeah, you're right. This is a good rivalry. Two storied programs in the SEC that have a ton of postseason experience. And like you said, it's come down to the pitching in this game. It's been really solid. We're seeing Natalie Lugo from Florida. Mary Wilson Avant is having a great start here in the bottom of the second. Mixing speeds, you can see both of them. Their changeups have been on fire. And that's what's to be expected. I mean, when you have Mary Wilson Avant in the circle for Georgia, she's their true ace. She's the one that leads them, and you need a good pitching performance from her if you want to get through Gainesville and get your way to the College World Series.
Yeah, she was the one in the circle when Georgia picked up their regular season win against the Gators. First time that Avant has had a three-ball count today. No hits in this game for either team, and now it runs full to Jamie Hoover.
Key characteristic that you're going to see with these two starting pitchers is their ability to throw the changeup in any count. Both of them have confidence in that pitch. We've seen both of these teams, especially the Gators so far, as being off balance, not really being able to time up anything, haven't hit anything solid yet. And really and truly, the same goes for Georgia.
Back back-to-back strikeouts for Avant, her third strikeout of the afternoon.
Mary Wilson Avant is just dealing out there in the circle. Goes inside tight on the hands for strike three.
Georgia, Florida, it's always going to draw the fans here in Gainesville. Game one of this Super Regional. Courtney Lyle, Caleb Rowe with you. Last weekend, Florida was outstanding. Their defense was so impressive.
They know what their strengths are, and their strengths is without a doubt their defense. Their ability to not only make the routine plays, but make some big-time flashy plays. They're top five in the country in fielding percentage, and they're top 10 in ERA.
Yeah, they were impressive, have not allowed a run in this tournament so far, but they're facing a Georgia team who can swing the bat. So far, though, neither team has a hit today as Jane Fields steps up to start this third inning. Their home run numbers as a group are pretty solid.
They got a ton of pop, 1-9. They can hit the ball out of the park. And they're a young team that's aggressive at the plate.
Now, Lou Harris-Champer has put together a scrappy group. They've had a great mindset the last few weeks. Jaden Fields, we told you they can go yard! A leadoff home run for Jaden Fields.
Jaden Fields gets in the box and she's ready to go on this pitch from Natalie Lugo. You can see right here, takes a little bit off of it and Jaden Fields times it up perfectly. She's sitting on this pitch, she's ready for it and strokes it beautifully dead center to get Georgia on the board. And this is what makes Georgia so scary, is anytime they can strike 1-9, they have pop in their lineup.
Yeah, just look back to their regional final. They won 10-9. I mean, it was just people slugging the softball all over the place, and Georgia wasn't afraid as Bordeaux shoots one to Lindemann at first.
And you can see Georgia right now is starting to make a few adjustments. You can tell they're a little bit more on time. Even that last line out was a loud out. It was well struck just right to somebody. And they understand their MO. They know they need to score runs to be productive. However, they can help out Avant, and the circle is going to be huge for them. But specifically what impresses me about this Georgia offense is despite the fact that sometimes they're down, even if they give up runs, they know that they can score in bunches and they can score quickly.
Yeah, get this, Caleb. That was the first extra base hit that Florida has allowed since May 13th when they faced Missouri.
I mean, that shows you how lights out their pitching staff has been. Just so consistent. And what the Gators do the best is they hit the corners. They pound the edges of the strike zone, and you could see right there on that last pitch from Lugo that Jaden Fields hit out of the park. It was a miss. It was a little bit too much right over the plate.
And Georgia knew they would have to take advantage of every little miss they got because Florida has been so solid. This is the first time they've allowed a run in the tournament. Good pitch, Matt. Good pitch. We got to show you this one again from Jaden Fields.
You can see a little bit too much over the white. Jaden Fields jumps all over that. There's a slight drop in the velocity, but she's sitting on that pitch. She's sitting on that speed, and she crushes it. It was a no-doubter.
2-2 count to Ellie Armistead. Over the hand of Hannah Adams. And a couple of hits in this inning for Georgia, the first of the game for either team.
Something that Georgia has been able to do really well this season, specifically their righties, is they hit the curveball pretty well. They have a good opportunity to go oppo often because they stay in their swings. They make sure their extension goes to the opposite field. And even on that one, it's off the end of the bat for Armistead, but she'll take it because she stays through the zone long enough to pick up a single.
Top of the order, Savannah Sykes. This time with a runner on. Sykes hitting 286 with runners on base. A much different inning for Natalie Lugo. She only threw 10 pitches to Georgia in the second. Yeah.
I think that's something we're going to see as this Georgia team is coming up through the lineup the second time, is what pitch do I sit on? Because Lugo has a very specific arsenal of pitches. She can throw the changeup, and you're going to see that at least once in your at-bat. So we saw Jaden Field sit on the off-speed. That was what she wanted to look for. We saw Armistead go after the curveball. So I think as these players come up second time around, you're going to see them look for specific pitches and be a little bit more confident and have a better plan round two. And, you know, if they touch her up pretty early in this game, wouldn't be shocked if we see Elizabeth Hightower come in, try and mix things up.
Yeah, you saw her warming up in the bullpen, fresh off of a no-hitter last Sunday in the regional final. But Lugo getting the start today, and she's behind right now, 3-0. Second time that she's had a three-ball count, and they've both come against Savannah Sykes. Yeah, Sykes is smart. You got to make her throw something. Armistead on first, thanks to the single. Gets the out, but Armistead bumps over to second. She is in scoring position. Georgia led off this inning with a solo shot from Jaden Fields. And that brings us to Sydney Kuma. She's got a big bat, too. Had three home runs in one day when they played Georgia State and Miami of Ohio back in February. 14 long balls on the season.
And she had a really nice regional tournament, hitting 500 on the weekend at three RBIs. She's also one of those young players in the lineup that keeps getting better as the season progresses, keeps getting smarter at the plate, and has the potential to hit the ball out of the park as well.
Checked it, and Lindemann will make an easy out. How about this to start the third inning?
Jaden Fields sitting on what she wants and absolutely crushes this out of the park. 1-0, Dogs are up.
This is the party that every player wants to be at.
It's going to be passionate softball for sure.
Back to crown a national champion for the first time since 2019.
They get to chase history here.
June 3rd is the date, noon Eastern on ESPN. The Women's College World Series is back. Who will be there? One of these teams will be moving on to face either Texas or Oklahoma State. That game in action right now over on ESPN2. It is best 2 out of 3 here in the Super Regional round. Oklahoma got a win over Washington just a few moments ago. Game one of that series. But we've seen some upsets too, with Virginia Tech beating UCLA. FSU beat LSU, who's a better seeded team.
It's been a great run so far. Even that Oklahoma-Washington game was close. The Alabama-Kentucky game was tight again today. So I think you're at the point, 16 teams are left. There's so much parity in our sport. These are the top 16 teams in the entire country. They all deserve to be here. And it's going to come down to those last little moments. Who's going to come up with that one clutch hit that they need? Who's going to make that pitch with the bases loaded?
Well, Jaden Fields has been clutch so far for Georgia. A leadoff home run in the third. And now she's back out in right field as Mary Wilson Avant delivers to Bailey Goddard. Avant has been spectacular so far. 3 strikeouts. She has struck out the last 2 batters. Remember, she's a graduate student. Already has a job lined up for when she's done pitching. Mature and leads this Georgia defense.
Talking with Coach Baldwin about Mary Wilson Avant, it was very obvious that he sees her as playing chess instead of checkers. I mean, her mental game, her ability to move pitches, to read batters, to put balls where the batter's weaknesses are what have made her so excellent this season. And she's definitely not a thrower. She's a pure pitcher that understands what the movement and the placement means and how she's going to use that to disadvantage the hitters at the plate.
Yeah, she's got wins this season over this Florida team and over Oklahoma. That'll be the first one she has walked today. But we got the chance to talk to Mary Wilson, and we asked her about her high school coach because it was Jeff Treadway who played for the Atlanta Braves for a long time. You see them there. He's become a family friend. He's coached her older sisters. And she said he really pushed her to attack batters in high school, and that helped her get that tough mentality.
It's all about the mentality. It's about the confidence to go out there and say that my stuff is good. Yes, I have great movement. Yes, I have great spin. But the fearlessness to go compete one-on-one versus the batter and say, I'm going to do what I need to do to get you out. And then to carry that into your confidence, into your presence, into how you look in the circle, so important. And that's such a big piece of elevating your game, is getting that mental fortitude to be able to say, hey, I'm going to go out and dominate my competition each and every time I step onto the circle.
Facing number 8 hitter, Sarah Longley. Ahead, 0-2. And we were asking Tim Walton about the difference in Mary Wilson Avan as he was scouting and getting ready for his team. Remember, they faced her in 2018 in the first game of the Women's College World Series. And he said the difference now is she can hit every spot with all of her pitches.
And that's a huge learning process for pitchers. Sometimes so often we see pitchers trying to throw everything. They try and throw 5 or 6 different pitches, and they can't control them. Well, Mary Wilson Avant can throw 5 or 6 different pitches, and now she's got the precision to put them where she wants.
Strikeout number 4.
And this is where Mary Wilson Avant is so good. She's been able to strike out on a number of different pitches today. This one's her curveball, and you can see not only does it move away from Longley, but it also has some break upward. So it's not a traditional rise ball, but it's really good moving up and away. And that's where she's effective. She can hit all quadrants. She's not afraid to go inside or outside to both righties and lefties. She'll sprinkle in the changeup pretty often. And she's just really tough. When she's on, she's one of the best pitchers in the country. And like you said, has had the ability to beat teams like Florida, to beat teams like Oklahoma this season.
And I think, too, as the season has gone on, as they get the strike call, she's realized that, you know, she's not going to be perfect every pitch, but she's got her team to back her up now because they are coming through with the bats, too.
And she's resilient. I think about Game 1, she goes out and beats Florida. Gets them again in the series for Game 3. And she stays out there for 8 runs.
Georgia will get one, but Goddard's safe at first.
And we see multiple times this season, too, where Mary Wilson Avant will start a game, she'll come back out, and then they'll re-enter her to finish. So, again, her confidence, her resiliency is a key factor in this game. She's not going to be too upset if she gives up a couple runs here and there. She's got to trust her offense to go support her and keep doing her thing in the circle.
Yeah, Rachel Fico is going to come out now, the pitching coach for Georgia, to talk to this infield. I mean, we saw Mary Wilson Avant did not get the start in their regional final. It was Britton Rogers, but then she came in and entered in a tough situation.
She came in a very tough situation. She recorded 6 of the last 7 outs of the ball game, was lights out, and that's exactly what you want out of your senior veteran pitcher to come in and close down a game, shut the opponent down, and get yourselves a ticket to the Super Regional weekend.
So a conversation here before facing the top of the order for the second time. It is Hannah Adams, a 368 hitter with a runner on.
Fire!
Adams 2-for-10 in the tournament coming into today. Doesn't have a hit just yet. Third time that Mary Wilson Avent has had a three-ball count. Still hasn't given up a hit. Second walk of the inning. Avant walked the leadoff batter, Bailey Goddard, two on. First time that Florida has had a runner in scoring position. So now you get to Emily Wilkie, who played a big role for Florida in that SEC tournament. They didn't have Cottrell. She stepped up, playing in the DP role today. But she was tough in the box at the SEC tournament, drew a walk, and was hit by a pitch four times.
And this is something that Florida's been looking for throughout the season, is somebody to step up in that two spot behind Hannah Adams and before Charlotte Echols. And she fits that bill. She has quality at bats. She battles in there, and that's why she's in there.
Call that one a strike, and you can hear the Florida Gator fans not happy about it. Wow. A fifth strikeout for Mary Wilson Avant. We will talk to Florida head coach Tim Walton when we come back.
Mary Wilson Avant sets her up with the curve, or with the changeup, a little off speed right here, and then goes hard with the curve for strike three.
You're watching the NCAA Softball Super Regionals presented by Capital One. Here in Gainesville, Florida, in game one of this Super Regional best 2 out of 3. We're joined now by Florida head coach Tim Walton. And coach, why did you like Natalie Lugo to start this game against these Georgia hitters?
Well, with a little bit of history, she pitched really well against them in Athens. She pitched really well for us on Saturday in our region. She's got good change, which obviously that was the pitch that Fields hit out, but good change and can throw a little bit harder on the hands if we need to. But just felt like it was the right matchup.
Coach, you're seeing Mary Wilson Avant throw quite a variety of pitches. Is there anything you're telling your offense to sit on or look for when they go up to the plate?
No, not too much, Kayla. I mean, statistics don't lie. Her statistics against left-handed hitters are about 140 points, higher than they are against right-handers. She's tough on right-handers. We're figuring out why today. Got that little rise that's a little bit slower than all the other pitches, and her change is pretty good. So we just got to do a better job. Get her back in the zone. We got to do a better job. Use the whole field.
Awesome, Coach. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now, Mary Wilson Avant has looked solid. These Georgia hitters, though, it looked like they got on Lugo a little bit more. Jaden Fields led off the last inning with a home run. Ellie Armistead had a hit, the first two hits of the ball game for Georgia off of Lugo.
Yeah, they're slowly starting to chip away, make some adjustments, and I love the fact that Fields sat on the changeup. You know she's going to throw it. That's such a smart move for some of these hitters. If that's the pitch that you feel confident that you can hit, you should absolutely sit it against Lugo until you get two strikes.
Lacey Fincher leading off the fourth. And Fincher had a really good regional last weekend. All these players, it's a long season. They go through ups and downs. She just felt really good. She had time to train, and that made a difference when she stepped in the box. Hopper to Echols at third, one away. It's been crazy how many times this Florida team has faced a familiar foe, if you will. This is the sixth straight Super that the Gators have played an SEC team.
That's an incredible stat. And, it's unfortunate in some ways for the Gators because you crave in the postseason wanting to get out of your conference. You've seen these teams over and over again. You've already played Georgia 3 times, for example. You don't want to face them again. You want to face somebody new that doesn't know you But, hey, we talked to Coach Walton about that, and he said, you know, we just deal with it. It's normal for us now. You still got to show up and play. You got to win your regional and your super regional no matter what to get to the World Series. And oftentimes that comes with playing against the best in the country, and the SEC has some of the very best in the country year after year.
Jose Mosley did not go on that one, so the count runs 2-1. Yeah, this is one of three super regionals that put conference teams back together. There's two from the SEC, and then, of course, there's one from the Big 12, Texas and Oklahoma State. Well, back in 2016, it was actually these two teams meeting, and it was crazy because a pinch-hit walk-off home run from Kaylee Puailoa sent Georgia to the Women's College World Series. They upset the number one seed in this tournament, which was Florida.
And Florida was looking to three-peat. They had just won back-to-back national championships. Lou Hersham and her team come in, and they upset one of the biggest upsets of all time in a super regional. And you know, that's what makes this rivalry so good, is there's moments like this. They play a lot in the postseason. They're both frequent visitors to the Women's College World Series. And not to mention, it's Georgia versus Florida.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a classic SEC rivalry.
Yeah. That back in 2016 was just the second time, Kayla, that a 16 has eliminated a one seed. The other one was in 2010, I'm sorry to say.
I was like, don't bring it up.
Hawaii beat Alabama.
That's right. Yes, I know what it's like to be the number one team and get upset. It is not easy.
Well, if it's going to happen this year, Washington has got to win tomorrow and on, what day is it? On Sunday.
Yep.
It's been a wild ride.
And they got a big game this weekend tomorrow. It's going to be on ABC, 3 Eastern.
Yes.
That's a huge deal.
Yeah, first time that softball is on ABC. We could not be more excited. Oklahoma took the win in game one today, 4-2. Lugo in front of Jada Kearney. Back to Lugo. Just a 12-pitch inning for Florida. We will talk to Lou Harris-Champer when we come back. Her Dogs up by one. Welcome back to the NCAA Softball Super Regionals presented by Capital One. Game one of the Super Regional here in Gainesville, Florida, and Georgia has a 1-0 lead on the Gators. It is best 2 out of 3, and the winner will move on to the Women's College World Series that starts next week. They'll get either Texas or Oklahoma State. Game one of that series right now over on ESPN2. Well, Georgia has sent out Mary Wilson Avant to the circle, and she has looked really solid. She already has 5 strikeouts in this game, and these Florida hitters are having a hard time adjusting.
We haven't seen Florida put really one hard ball into play today. They haven't stroked it really well to say, hey, I'm getting on time, all barrel, and that's credit to Mary Wilson Avant, what she's been able to do. Talk about the deceptive speed change. She's got a great changeup. That rise ball comes in a little bit slower than the rest of her pitches, and then she's able to hit the corners. And Mary Wilson Avant has been doing this all season long. She's so skilled. She's so strong. See right there, boom, drop ball. Then she goes inside, and then she can break it away with that curve ball, and she can just blow it by you too. Good velocity, good movement, good late break that makes her really effective.
She hasn't thrown more than 16 pitches in an inning today. She did walk 2 batters in the third, but Florida hasn't been able to make contact. They will start off with Sharla Eccles. Second time she has seen Mary Wilson Avant is on a 9-game hit streak. This could be a great way to bust out of this because Eccles is electric at the plate.
What a good opportunity for the Gators to be able to get themselves to start off an inning fresh. Sharla Eccles is who you want up to the plate. And it's because she's just so simple. Her swing is just clean, it's crisp, and it's consistent. And she honestly reminds me of somebody like a Bailey Hemphill. And we've credited these two hitters so often this season for having really unslumpable swings. And it's because they understand barrel control. And they understand that simple sometimes is better. You can see right here, Charlotte Eccles has a beautiful, clean, tight swing. Look how fast her hands are. Look how efficient her barrel is getting to the ball and getting through the zone. She generates a ton of power very, very quickly, and it's because she's not trying to do too much in the box.
Sykes has to leap up in the air to get it, and what a stretch by Lacey Fincher to pick up the out. Georgia's defense looking solid today. We've mentioned there have been some ups and downs for these Bulldogs in the field, but today looked pretty good behind Mary Wilson.
Yeah, so far they've been really clean.
This is Kendall Lindemann. And when we talked to Tim Walton, you heard him say it's been a struggle for the right-handed hitters against Mary Wilson Avan.
Yeah, she's been dominating right-handed hitters all day. And Coach Walton talked about this discrepancy in batting average of right-handers to left-handers. And the biggest key for me is I think that curveball away from right-handers really does a great job having late bite, late movement. And this will try and go squeeze one on the inside corner to righties, but it's that curveball to righties that is really tough to get to.
Three balls and a strike to Lindemann. There's a hit. The first one today for Florida. Lindemann looking for two. We'll get it. Kendall Lindemann busting out.
Kendall Lindemann, such a veteran hitter, understands her role in this lineup. Second time around, gets something high and inside, makes an adjustment, stays on plane, and just ropes this down the left field line to pick up a nice double. And it's no surprise here who's going to break up the opportunity, who's going to break up the no-no. It's got to be Kendall Lindemann. And the reason is because she's so mature at the plate. She knows what it takes to be a good hitter. She's played at Minnesota and now Florida and has the ability to make quality adjustments at the plate, stayed really level in that swing, and picks up a nice opportunity for the Gators.
Yeah, a three-time All-American, and now she's in scoring position for Julia Cottrell, who struck out the first time against Mary Wilson Avan. And, you know, we talked to Kendall Lindemann because she is one of the veterans on this team, as you mentioned. And she said, I talked to the team about nerves before the SEC tournament. Yeah, it's fine to have them before, but when that first pitch is thrown, you've got to shake them off and be ready. And she just set a great example for Florida.
And that's something else. That it's so unexpected when you hear statistics like this, but this is a young Florida team as well. We talk about how young the Georgia team is. Florida's young. They have a lot of inexperience because of that COVID year, because of the timing of everything. They have some players that are new to Super Regional experience.
Yeah, and Julia Cottrell is one of them. Just a sophomore, had that shortened season last year. She did start every game last year and has started the majority of this year, but her first Super.
And this is a tough environment to play in.
Just foul. Look, Julia Cottrell, she may not have played in a Super, but she's seen it. Her dad, Jeff, is an assistant coach at Oklahoma State. Now, keep in mind, they're in action right now. And if they advance and Florida advances, they would meet in game one of the Women's College World Series next week. strikeout. Cottrell goes down swinging. Mary Wilson has gotten to these Florida hitters.
Goes with the drop ball. Look at the break on that. It looks like it's going to hang right at the knees, and at the last second, falls right to the ankles of Cottrell. She's off balance. She's out in front. And Avant gets the best of her in that at bat.
All six strikeouts by Mary Wilson. Avant have been swinging today. Jamie Hoover plus one to Kuma. And Florida is going to leave a runner in scoring position. Kendall Lindemann gets the first hit on the board, but she gets stuck. Well, coming up tomorrow, Saturday at 3 Eastern over on ABC, we will get to see Oklahoma and Washington battle. How fun will that be? The very first time that we will have softball on ABC. And it was Oklahoma today getting the win 4-2. Jocelyn Allo had another home run to help the Sooners get the job done.
Man, that Sooners offense is just something that you love to watch if you like hitting. And the reason is that they all look like professionals up there. I mean, they are so good 1-9, and even off the bench, they have some really good power hitters off the bench. But their approach, their mentality, their aggressiveness, I mean, we saw it last weekend, Courtney. They are unreal. Go watch them.
Yeah, 50 runs on the board last weekend in their regional, 12 home runs. In the seventh inning of their regional final, they scored 10 runs and hit 4 home runs.
And two of my favorite players to watch on that team are the two freshmen, Tiare Jennings and Jada Coleman. Both of them just look so mature beyond their years. They play such a pivotal role for the offense. You have Tiare Jennings, who's in the leadoff spot. That's this calm, consistent presence. And then you have Jada Coleman coming up in the middle. That is a firecracker, somebody that you just love to watch play because of her energy out on the field.
Yeah, both finalists for the National Freshman of the Year. I loved watching Tiare Jennings. It was crazy how good she is at the plate.
Yeah, and they've got some crazy pop in their bat too. I mean, just 1-9, you cannot take a break if you are a pitcher against that team. I can't even imagine what it would feel like to go out in the circle and face them.
I'd say it's 1-the team because you can put a pitch hitter in and gone.
That's so true.
This is Sydney Chambly up. And she will walk. You know, we wondered how Oklahoma would fare against better pitching, and they saw that today with Gabby Plain in the circle. Because that's been the question for Oklahoma, is their schedule wasn't super tough, and they've put up a ton of runs, but I was interested to see how they did against Plain.
I got to be honest with you, if you're Washington and you went into that game knowing that Gabby Plain only gave up 4 runs, that's a winnable game for the Huskies. That's kind of what you imagine being the threshold. Okay, we have to put up at least 4 or 5 to be able to beat the Sooners. You're just not going to score less and win. Perfect example, early in the year when Georgia played Oklahoma. I mean, it was a high-scoring, big-time home run, a lot of production ball game. It wasn't a 2-1 pitcher's duel. It was a home run fest.
Jaden Fields was big in that Oklahoma game. She has been big in this game. She's the reason that Georgia is up 1-0. Let off the third inning with a home run. And I love the response too. We have seen her come in as a sub, especially last weekend. Today she gets the start and boom, gone. Second hit of the game for Jaden Fields.
You know, sometimes you just get a feeling as a coach, whose time is it, who's going to do well, and today it was Jaden Fields' turn. She sits on the changeup on her first at-bat, hits one out of the park, and then gets a little curveball on the outside corner, and does a beautiful job of keeping it simple, spraying it to the opposite field. I mean, she's got a really nice swing. She does a great job of controlling that barrel and puts a runner in a scoring position for Georgia with no outs.
Peyton Bordeaux. It's going to drop. And that loads the bases. Just popped up on the first pitch and somehow found the room.
Yeah, this is a little jam sandwich. Bordeaux in on the hands, finds a way to muscle it out, and it just falls perfectly in between left, center, and the shortstop position. And all of a sudden, here we go. Bulldogs, bases loaded, no outs, trying to get something going and have an opportunity to put a big exclamation point on this ball game.
It'll be Ellie Armistead, the number nine hitter, up with the bases loaded. Already has a hit off of Lugo.
And we gotta give credit here. The bottom of the lineup has done so well for Georgia today. Obviously, you have a 7-8-9 home run from Jaden Fields, a base hit from Armistead, and then two base hits once again from Jaden Fields and Peyton Bordeaux.
Eccles throwing home, looking for two. Tag is applied! Sarah Longley got over there, made the tag, and Florida gets two.
The Florida defense is always ready to go. They don't panic. Eccles makes this play look easy. It's a hard hit off the bat of Armistead. She makes a beautiful throw to Cottrell at home, and then Cottrell sees an opportunity to get the out at third. Longley doesn't panic, stays with the ball, and as Jaden Fields comes off the base, she's able to get the second out of the inning.
That's what we're talking about. This Florida defense makes incredible plays. And Sharla Eccles told Tim Walton when she came to Florida, I don't want to be a catcher center field. I want to play on the infield, and she loves third base.
Yeah, and that's a huge miscue for Georgia. Jaden Fields lets her momentum take her off third base, and all of a sudden you go from one out, bases loaded, to two outs, a runner on second and first. But that's what it's all about for defense and Sharla Eccles and Sarah Longley at shortstop is capitalizing when the other team makes a base running error, you take advantage and you get them out. I gotta be honest too, I thought it was an interesting call for Cottrell to go home to third and try and get the force out over at third instead of going to first. I think she would have had more time, it would have been an easier play. But nonetheless, the defense steps up and gets the out anyway.
Now it's a ball and a strike to Savannah Sykes. Sykes has not reached tonight. Lindsay. Gators defense though, chomp chomp.
Gators have one of the best defenses in the entire country and they show it off right here. Eccles to Cottrell to Longley, off the base and out of the inning.
Ladies, thank you, Allison Fiebre, former Georgia Bulldog. That we're keeping an eye on that Super Regional because the winner of this Super Regional will go on to face either Oklahoma State or Texas. Whoever wins that series, they will see that team first in the Women's College World Series that starts next week. Bailey Goddard leaving off. Things get even a little spicier, too, if you're Florida because Florida's catcher, Julia Cottrell, her dad is an assistant at Oklahoma State. How fun would that be?
Yeah, a little father-daughter rivalry heading into the World Series would be interesting to see.
Obviously, he didn't see it, but Cottrell was a part of that double play because he's coaching in a game right now. But Julia yeah. just helped them turn that double play. Here they are. Remember, Oklahoma State beat Florida State in 2019 to advance to the Women's College World Series. Julia went with her dad. She did say she wore white to be neutral. Was committed to Florida, but hadn't played for them yet. And Mary Wilson gets her seventh strikeout today.
but what an addition Cottrell has been for Florida. And that last inning could be crucial for Georgia moving forward. They had the bases loaded.
It could be a really big factor in this ball game. One-run lead isn't enough against the Gators. And Mary Wilson Avent is pitching excellent right now. But that was an opportunity for Georgia. And it was a really strange play. But unfortunately, you can't make that mistake and run yourselves out of an inning to give up that opportunity. And Georgia did that to himself. And it's a situation they're going to want back later on. And because of that, next play is a fly ball to the outfield. That is out number three. That might be a sac fly.
Sarah Longley up now, ahead on Avant 2-0. Yeah, the game that Georgia won in the regular season against Florida, it was 4-2. Mary Wilson Avant threw a one-hitter in that game. She's only given up one hit so far. It was a double to Kendall Lindemann, but she got stuck at second.
Yeah, Mary Wilson Avant game one is so fresh today. She proved that the regular season. She's so tough when you've only seen her a couple times. Florida made some really good adjustments and were more effective against her later in the series. And the other thing that I look at is Mary Wilson Avent plays such an important factor, because in game two, where she did not pitch, Florida scored 17 runs on Georgia. They threw six different pitchers and they gave up 17 runs. That's a lot.
In that series as a whole, Florida outscored Georgia 27-6 during the regular season as Merrick Wilson gets back-to-back Ks.
Gets a K looking here. It's a little backdoor curve right at the belt. Gets a Longley was just perplexed. Didn't really know what she was looking for. Wasn't ready to battle with two strikes and takes a walk back to the dugout because of it.
Center second hit for Georgia, for Florida, excuse me, off of Georgia.
And this is a really important hit. The bottom of the lineup has got to come through for Florida. And thus far, the bottom of the lineup has been 0-for with one walk and seven strikeouts until that Cheyenne Lindsay hit. And what that does is it turns the lineup over so Hannah Adams, who has home run potential, who has high average potential, is up at the plate.
Adams has reached once today on a walk. Remembers this Georgia team well. Her first career game at the Women's College World Series was against Georgia. They run-ruled the Bulldogs. That was against Mary Wilson Avant. Cheyenne Lindsay at first. She is their stolen base leader, but you got to be careful. Two outs. The extra hustle from Sydney Chambly, and for the second time, Florida will strand a runner. They're down one. Georgia's in the lead thanks to the long ball. Back in the third inning, Jaden Fields leading off with a solo shot out to center field. It's been the difference so far in this game. That combines with some great pitching.
Mary Wilson Avent has been on fire today, doing an excellent job of mixing speeds and spins. She is perplexing this Gator offense, and her ability to go out and command her pitches is why she has given up only two hits today and given up zero runs.
Florida has given up 4 hits. Keep in mind, in their entire regional, all 3 games combined, they only allowed 3 hits. And today, Georgia's bats in tune, given up 4. Natalie Lugo getting the start, still in the circle here in the 6th inning, and we'll start off with Sydney Kuma. Georgia had a huge opportunity to extend this lead, and you really, a 1-run lead against Florida is scary because we've seen them just 4 walk-offs in this month of May alone. But they had the opportunity in the 5th, had the bases loaded, and Florida turned a double play for the 27th time this season. Kuma, no problem for Adams. 1 away. We'll have a trio of NBA playoff game 3s for you coming up tonight. We'll start in the ATL with the Knicks and the Hawks at 7 Eastern on ESPN. The Nets and the Celtics are on ABC at 8:30 Eastern. And then we cap the night with Clippers-Mavs at 9:30 Eastern on ESPN. And of course, all 3 games available on the ESPN app, so you don't miss a single possession. Lacey Fincher to Echols. That was quick. 2 down now. And reminder, too, all of these Super Regionals, you can take them with you streaming live on the ESPN app. It's great. Every game has its own window. Of course, we're going to see Oklahoma and Washington on ABC tomorrow at 3 Eastern. The first time we've had softball on ABC.
We've already seen some great storylines. Virginia Tech upsetting UCLA in game 1, so that's going to be a great game 2 tonight.
Sarah Mosley, a quick inning for this Florida defense. They got to get the bats going. They're down by 1. Super Regionals, it's a rivalry too. It makes it even more exciting. The 5th time these 2 teams have met in the postseason. The last time was in 2018 in the World Series. Florida defeated Georgia, but in Supers, last time was 2016, and it was Georgia walking off in game 2 with a pinch hit home run to send Florida home and Georgia to Oklahoma City. Courtney Lyle, Caleb Breaux with you. Mary Wilson Avant has been fantastic. I don't know what else you can say about how solid she's been.
I mean, she's been so efficient too. Only 73 pitches so far in the game. That just tells me that she has been really, really strong with her command. She's attacking hitters like we talked about earlier. And with the exception of a couple hits for Florida, I mean, she's really made very, very few mistakes. She's induced easy outs for her defense, which is so important with a young defense playing behind you.
8 strikeouts on the afternoon for Avant. Emily Wilkie skies it. Armistead calling everybody off. 1 away. Any adjustments that stand out for Florida? I mean,
I think this is the biggest challenge, is that, you know, we've seen her really mix it up. She's not getting into patterns. She's not throwing the same thing to every batter. She's really trying to pinpoint their mistakes. And a lot of their swings are on the big K, swings and misses, or miss hits. We've seen a lot of pop outs, a lot of easy ground ball outs. So the timing has just not been there. And I think about the couple good hits on the day so far. I think about Kendall Lindemann getting something inside a little bit elevated, and she turns on it and crushes it.
And obviously any rally caps and rally visors that Florida can get right now,
that's
they're
right.
going to take. The Twizzler is key on the towel. That's key.
Obviously, why wouldn't you put a Twizzler on there?
I wore that this morning. Charlotte Echols looking for her first hit. She came in on a 9-game hit streak. Lines 1 to Armistead. 2 down.
And that's the best piece of hitting that we've seen from Echols today. Goes right to Armistead. And sometimes just how this game goes, you hit something hard, Armistead playing a little bit up the middle, is in the right place at the right time for the second out of the inning. And Avant continues to cruise.
Kendall Lindemann, she had the double. That was the first hit that Florida got off of Mary Wilson Avant today.
Something really important too, we talked to Coach Baldwin, the assistant coach for Georgia, before this ball game. If you have the chance, if you have an opportunity to walk Lindemann and Echols, will you? They haven't needed to today. There's been nobody on base in front of them throughout this ball game. And that makes a huge difference that you can go be fearless and pitch to the best hitters in the lineup without the risk of a 2 or 3 run home run.
Ooh, strike two.
This is a beautiful pitch right here. Avant, change up, pulling the string. And Lindemann's not sitting on it. That's a really good location. That's low in the zone. And that's a nice strike. And again, last at bat, Lindemann strokes a high pitch down the line. So what do? You go with the off speed, try and keep her off balance and keep her guessing.
2-2 to Lindemann. She does it again. It's fair. Kendall Lindemann. It rolls to the corner, and she has her second double of the evening.
Well, this is the kind of intelligence that Kendall Lindemann has, because she gets a similar pitch and off-speed once again. Same changeup, same location, and this time she's ready for it. She sits on it with two strikes, barely gets it down the line and fair. And for the second time today, Kendall Lindemann standing on two with a double.
Ninth double on the season, the second one that Lindemann has had tonight. And now Julia Cottrell is up. She was not able to help out Lindemann. She has struck out twice, and there'll be a pinch runner for Florida. Callie Reese. And you see Kendall Lindemann immediately communicating with Julia Cottrell.
And that right there is the veteran and the experience that Kendall Lindemann brings. She's going and talking to a player, her teammate that doesn't have postseason experience, making sure she communicates effectively what the pitcher's throwing, but also giving her confidence, saying, hey, you got this. I believe in you. You can go out and do this right now.
Yeah, Lindemann 2-for-3. The rest of Florida 1-for-17. She knows how to hit Avant. Jams around the first pitch. Armistead, yes. And Florida will leave a runner in scoring position again. Georgia on top by one.
The NCAA Softball Super Regionals is presented by Capital One. What's in your wallet?
You're watching the NCAA Softball Super Regionals presented by Capital One. Two teams battling for a spot in Oklahoma City. We've got game one of this best of three series here in Gainesville. Texas and Oklahoma State, that's currently on ESPN2. These two teams, one of them will get the winner of that series. And the difference has been Jaden Fields, a solo home run, but the only run on the board. And Mary Wilson Avant has been fantastic in the circle. Natalie Lugo heating up, though. She only threw 5 pitches in the last inning.
I was going to say, really, too, Natalie Lugo has been fantastic also. If you're only giving up one run to this potent Georgia offense, you're doing a good job out there. And really, truly, she's made one mistake. And you have to give credit to Jaden Fields. She sat on your best pitch, and sometimes you just got to tip your cap on that one pitch. But beyond that, her defense has helped her out, coming up with a big-time play with the bases loaded to help her get out of a jam.
Yeah, they turned a double play in the 5th inning. She's only walked one batter, struck out 3. Sydney Chambly up at the plate right now.
Yeah.
Chamblee swung a nice bat in the regional for Georgia, drove in the game-winning run in the bottom of the sixth inning in that regional final against Duke. Remember, Georgia was hosting, but Duke was the seeded team, and they were knocked out by these Dogs. Chamblee will walk. I mean, this game, one of the supers, is so important. Just look at the percentages right now, because if you come out and you're able to win game one, history shows 81% of the time you're moving on to the Women's College World Series.
It's a crazy statistic, and it is so hard for teams to come back after dropping game one. It takes a lot of momentum. It's taxing. Your backs are against the wall. It's a lot of pressure to know that if we lose, we're done. And a lot of teams don't handle that really well.
The only run on the board was from the bat of Jaden Fields. Georgia, by the way, 23-0 when leading after five innings.
No, I look at that stat and I think, wow, Georgia is so strong at the end. But then I look at the opposite and how strong Florida is to be able to come back and win games. I mean, 1-0, anything is possible, obviously. And with the way the Gators have been able to come back and have 8 walk-off victories this season, that is a scary fact right there for the Bulldogs.
Pitch well inside. Ball and 2 strikes to Fields. Both runners safe. Sarah Longley was having to run and throw back as her momentum was carrying her forward. That's tough.
Yeah, Longley had no chance on that one, especially because she was shifted up the middle a little bit because of Armistead being at first base. She's had a little different defensive shift on, and that slow roller in the 5-6 hole is just not going to have the time to make that play in this game.
So Lou Harris-Champer calls her runners over. Hayden Bordeaux, it will be the one up at the plate next. Georgia had an opportunity to put some more runs on the board in the fifth, had the bases loaded. This Florida defense turned an amazing double play to give them some momentum.
And really, that's been the key for Florida. We talk about their ability to be to win games late, and it's because of their defense keeps them in games. And that's something that this team recognizes, is that they have a skill set defensively that is one of the best in the country. And if they step up and do their jobs, their offense will have a shot.
Bordeaux picked up her first hit in the tournament in the fifth inning. She was 0-for-7 in regionals. Just a freshman, a true freshman. She didn't get the shortened season last year with Georgia. Had to step into the catching duties when Jessica Morgan was out with an injury. Morgan has been her biggest cheerleader, though. That's really helped her take over this role behind the plate.
And being catcher is so important, and to get that experience as a true freshman to come in and control the pace of the game, control your defense, but also because of her skill behind the plate and the necessity for a catcher, she's gotten a ton more at-bats and getting a ton of experience offensively that's going to pay dividends down the road as her career continues.
3 balls and a strike to Bordeaux with 2 on. A walk and a single is how Georgia put 2 on base. Eccles diving into the dugout. Wow, she almost had that in her glove.
What a beautiful effort from Eccles over at third base. doing her best to get over and make this play, but you can tell just hitting that netting and falling into the dugout makes the ball pop out at the last second, not able to hang on to it.
Full count to Bordeaux. Left field. Over the fence! Peyton Bordeaux goes yard, just the fourth home run for her on the season.
Again and again, Natalie Lugo challenged the freshman on the inside corner of the plate, but the freshman comes back and makes an adjustment. Tries to go tight in, little backdoor curveball. Peyton Bordeaux takes this thing for a ride. Just lines it out over the fence to give Georgia the four-run lead in the top of the seventh inning. Talk about clutch for your team and being able to score quickly. The Georgia Bulldogs are so dangerous because of their home run ability.
We've seen it time and time again. Remember, this is a Georgia team. They trailed by 7 runs to Kentucky in the regular season. Bounced back, got a 3-run homer from Sarah Mosley. I mean, anybody can do it in this lineup. And you see the savage chain around Peyton Bordeaux's neck. They get that for home runs.
And they went toe-to-toe with the Oklahoma Sooners as well. I can't help but go back to that game. You talk about moments and games during the season that give you confidence and let you know that you can beat anybody, anytime, anywhere. That's one of them right there. You go beat the Sooners, you out-hit the Sooners, so you know when you go to Gainesville for a Super Regional that you can hit their pitching.
Now, Oklahoma had won 40 straight before facing Georgia. Ellie Armistead's got a 3-0 count. Second walk this inning.
You know, you look at this ball game too, and I can't help but go to the bottom of the lineups for both of these teams. And Georgia's bottom of the lineup came to play. Sydney Chamblee gets on with a couple walks. Jaden Fields, 2 hits and a home run. Peyton Bordeaux, 1 hit and another home run. And then you have Ellie Armistead, who comes out with a hit and then gets a walk right there. The bottom of their lineup was so productive today, and that's the difference, because you look at Florida right now, on the other side, bottom of the lineup, 1 hit, 5 Ks.
Wow. Top of the order is Savannah Sykes, and she has Ellie Armistead on thanks to that walk. Well, Tony Baldwin told us, the associate head coach for Georgia, they've won games in so many different ways. It's been different people stepping up. You saw it last weekend in those games that they played in the regional, and he liked that coming in to a grinding series with Florida.
No, you're so right. There's so many moments where you look for your team just to understand how to win ball games. The regional is a great example of that. You win a 1-0 ball game tight against Duke in game one, and then you win a 10-9 ball game when you face them again to move on to Super Regionals.
And we're going to have a pitching change for Florida as Natalie Lugo will come out. Giving up a couple of home runs, the last being a 3-run shot to Peyton Bordeaux, and Georgia is up 4-0 here in game one of this Super Regional. Riley Trilicek will be in the circle for Florida. We'll show you what she's got when we come back to Gainesville. In the circle, Riley Trilicek comes in for the first time since May 1st. Against Missouri. We'll see her here against Savannah Sykes.
Yeah, the Gators make no mistake by putting Hightower in. There's no point in getting your ace in the circle in this game. And really for Trilicek, it's just going to come down to keeping the score the same. You have such a tough challenge if you're the Florida Gators to face Mary Wilson Avant in the bottom half of this inning to try and scratch away at this lead from Georgia. Especially with the way that Avant has just been able to shut down this Gators offense, with the exception of Kendall Lindemann.
So Trilicek will inherit 2 balls to Savannah Sykes. Natalie Lugo had thrown six straight balls, and then Tim Walton made the change here to Trilichek. Runner on first via the walk. Georgia has keyed in this inning. They started out, got a walk from Sydney Chambly, a single from Jaden Fields, her third hit of the day. That ties a career high for her. And then a three-run homer by Peyton Bordeaux. Georgia has struggled has been the top of the lineup, like you mentioned, Kayla. 7-8-9 in the lineup. They're 6-for-8. The rest of the Bulldogs hitting 0-for-16. Remember, Savannah Sykes hits in that top spot. Gators looking for two. You bet. Second time Florida has turned a double play. The Gators will have to do what they do. Walk it off when we come back because Georgia's gone yard.
Bordeaux putting an exclamation point into this swing, giving Georgia the big lead heading to the bottom of the seventh.
Georgia loves to swing for the fences, and that has been the difference. Jaden Field led off the third with a solo shot, and then Peyton Bordeaux, just her fourth home run of the season.
You gotta love to see Georgia Bulldogs put insurance runs on the board. You know how good Florida is late in the ballgame, so what do? You make sure you give Mary Wilson Avant some run support, and you do it the best way you know how with home run ball, which you've been dominating here in the postseason.
Eight home runs in this tournament for Georgia. Remember, they came in having lost their last seven games, hit the NCAA tournament with 3-0 last weekend, took down a seeded team, and they're three outs away from getting a win over Florida.
It's big time. Nobody's saving this tournament. We've already seen a couple upsets. This will be the first time that we see an unseeded team get a victory so far in the NCAA tournament super regional weekend.
So it will be the 6, 7, and 8 hitters. Jamie Hoover starting off. Hits have been at a premium today for Florida. Mary Wilson Avant has only given up 3 hits. 2 of those were 2 doubles to Kendall Lindemann, but they left her on base.
And really, this is a big moment for the Gators. Not only are you trying to chip away and come back in this ballgame, but without a doubt, you're going to see Avian again this weekend. So if you can pick something up, have a quality at bat, see something, pick up a pitch that you want to sit on for potentially tomorrow or Sunday's game, then you need to do that.
And Florida has seen that before. Remember, in the regular season series, Mary Wilson Avant was fantastic in game one against them, but they did pick out something. They were able to make the adjustments, so when they saw her again in game three, they put 8 runs on the board. You know, there's the difference from game one, just allowing 1 hit in the regular season series. Game three, Florida had 7 hits, scored 8 runs.
The other number that I look up is the 6 walks compared to the 3. Really working the free passes, having more quality at bats. And if you can't find ways to really hit a pitcher hard, find ways to foul pitches off and get to advantageous counts so that you can potentially pick up that free pass.
Strikeout number 9 by Avant.
Beautiful pitch right here for Avant. Goes with the drop ball. We've seen her throw this a few times today, but you can see right there the little late break. Tons of spin, tons of rotation on this pitch that caused Hoover to swing over the top of it for the first out of the inning.
Eight of those nine strikeouts have been swinging by Avant, and we're going to see a pinch hitter come in. Avery Gels. Getting 234 on the season. Last time we saw her was in that SEC tournament final against Alabama. She was 0-for-1 as a pinch hitter. One count. Avant's going to get over there for out number two. Wow, she has been so good.
In fielding her position, I mean, she has had one of her best performances of the entire season today against the Gators. She's dominated them in every single capacity. She has high strikeout numbers, really incredible movement, and it's no doubt that she's going to be the player of the game.
Yeah, that is tonight's Capital One player of the game. Three-hit shutout through 6 2/3, nine strikeouts. Her season high strikeouts, by the way, is 12. Obviously can't get there in this one. But an outstanding performance.
And the other thing I look at too is that she's only at 95 pitches, and we've seen her throw up to 150 pitches this season, so she's not going to be too taxed to be able to throw tomorrow.
Now this is Jordan Matthews pinch hitting. Yeah, do you throw her again tomorrow?
Yeah, I would. I think she's your best chance. I think that Florida has not proved that they can hit her consistently enough. And if she looks anything tomorrow like she does today, she's going to give the opportunity for Georgia to try and punch their ticket to Oklahoma City and keep the Bulldogs in the game. It's going to require some changes and some adjustments from this Florida offense if they want to beat her in this series.
Gators down to their last strike. Sykes on the move into the netting. Two balls, two strikes to Jordan Matthews. This will be the seventh pitch to Matthews, up next from Avant. Count runs full. Florida hitters have struggled to get on time with Mary Wilson Avant tonight, down to their final strike.
Matthews continues to battle, putting together a really good at-bat. This is what you want if you're the Gators. You get a pinch hitter in. That is a tough out right here. That's making Mary Wilson Avant just work and continue to work as this game is reaching its end and onto the last out. Anything that you can do to help yourself out for tomorrow matters.
back to Avan. The home run hitting Bulldogs have taken down Florida in Gainesville and got a gem of a performance from Mary Wilson Avant.
Mary Wilson Avant was lights out today. She brought it. The veteran came in dealing, ready to go. You come into a hostile environment playing the number four team in the country, and she looked so comfortable, so consistent, and she dominated from the first inning to the last.
Georgia, one win away from advancing to the Women's College World Series for the fifth time. They would face either Texas or Oklahoma State. What a performance it was. Home runs from Jaden Fields and a three-run shot from Peyton Bordeaux. Game two of this series will be tomorrow at noon Eastern on ESPN. A Georgia win moves them on to Oklahoma City.